Africa Lives on the BBC.
It's 12 noon in London, 7 a.m. in Philadelphia, and around the world, it's time for Live Aid.
They called it the greatest show on earth. 58 bands across the globe playing live in a 16-hour music marathon. It raised millions for the starving in Africa and put governments around the world to shame. But it was the day they thought would never happen.
When they told me about it, I thought, what a terrible idea.
I burst out laughing. I said, don't be ridiculous.
Not least because its creator was an unlikely hero. A foul-mouthed, fading pop star.
No, let's pop the address. Let's get the numbers.
It didn't strike me as a man searching around, you know, for a charitable role. Oh, it's either Live Aid or I'll join the Citizens Advice Bureau.
Yet he became the people's champion.
He will never, ever be able to lose the St. Bob tag.
And the tormentor of world-class superstars.
You don't say no to Bob.
Yeah, fucking that, yeah, Jesus Christ. You know, real good Irish passion coming at you.
And if he doesn't get you with the poetry, the spittle isn't far behind.
From the start, Live Aid was dogged by transatlantic rivalry.
America was horrendous.
Sabotage.
There was a spin put out. You're either being used, or people are going to make a lot of money off you, or it's not going to happen.
And superstar egos.
What the fuck do you think you're doing? I don't even speak to him. I'm not going to do it.
Many predicted catastrophe.
It looked like it would be a chaotic disaster.
Yet the skeptics would end up falling over themselves to get on board.
Let's not lie. Don't tell me there was one act there that wasn't aware that there would be more than a billion people watching.
It was a day many will never forget.
Everyone remembers where they were. Everyone remembers what they felt about it.
Everybody, it seems, except those who were there.
I think we went on first, didn't we? Yeah, it must have been
great.
First. Yeah, because obviously it was still daylight, wasn't it?
Don't even remember that.
Did we go in a helicopter? Did we?
I just wish I could remember more than I can. But that's because, as I said, I had a bloody good time.
For 16 hours, the country was united with joy and reduced to tears. Against all the odds, it was the day that music changed the world. December 1984, and a now familiar anthem was taking Britain by storm.
It's Christmas time.
In Africa, an aid worker and a journalist heard the song for the first time.
Stupid song and a stupid name for it, and how dare this guy make money out of poor starving people in Ethiopia.
I thought it was crap. I thought it was trite. I just thought, you know, what a load of drug-taking, cocaine-snorting, bonking pop singers got to do with all this. They're just doing it for their careers. The whole thing is bollocks, really.
I was busting my guts out to try and save these kids. And I thought somebody was taking advantage of them.
It wasn't true, but you could hardly blame them for being cynical. This was not a time of peace and brotherly love.
There was massive industrial change going on. The community I represented up in County Durham was basically losing all its old coal steel industries. And so it was a big moment of change in the country.
Inner cities burst into flames. Unemployment was rife. Left-wing councils and the country's most powerful union, the miners, were locked in a fight to the death with Mrs. Thatcher's Tory government.
And there was no greater anarchist than Scargill. So was Derek Hatton in Liverpool. The madness of the loony left.
Arthur Scargill, for me, became a tune-out human being. If he came onto the TV, I just turned it off. If you saw police on horseback, you thought, they don't know what they're up against.
As far as the black community were concerned,
We definitely felt that we were not a part of Thatcher's New Britain. We certainly got a sense that it was okay to be racist.
There seemed to be violence everywhere. And in football, we had, of course, the violence, the football fans, that the whole country was on edge and everybody's, you know, knocking hell out of each other.
But some were doing very nicely out of Mrs. Thatcher. In the cocooned world of pop, it was limos, larger-than-life hair, and loads of money.
The weird thing about Mrs. Thatcher was that even though we hated her, we were all getting rich because of her.
I was earning lots of money. That was the time. It was the heart of Thatcherism. Those few years, there was a lot of me going on, and money was king.
Everything was larger than life. The shoulder pads were larger than life. The way that we drank and the way that we did things was excessive. Bad boys!
This was big hair, a go-go. Wow. The mullets. And pop music had never felt so vapid.
One singer as well known for his bad hair and big mouth as his hit records was Bob Geldof, frontman of the Boomtown Rats.
I mean, I thought the Boomtown Rats were just crap, but, you know, and he can't sing.
By 1984, the hits and the money were drying up.
I was a fading pop singer, certainly fading, no longer relevant.
Dying on his feet. We got to a stage where we were thinking, well, we'll let him make one more record and we'll see how this goes.
I think we all felt he'd rather overstayed his welcome and shot his mouth off. And we felt to some extent, I think, that he was a pop star on the slide.
Geldof's girlfriend, Paula Yates, presenter of cult music show The Tube, was now the biggest star.
Bob occasionally hung around, you know, the dressing rooms and the canteen at Tynes Television when The Tube was being shot, like a big bad smell. And he always used to wear a big black leather coat and a hat just that said, you know, I'm a pop star. And he was so grumpy and horrible. I mean, everybody in Bob's world was a fucking bastard, you know, maybe with the exception of his partner and his daughter. So he wasn't that popular. People used to be very cruel to him, call him Mr. Paula Yates and everything, and I could see that hurt him.
But one autumn evening, Bob Geldof's life was about to change.
October makes me miserable anyway. Twilight makes me very uncomfortable. Around 4 o'clock, 4:15, in autumn days are, you know, the orange sodium lights flick on. Don't like it. So I came in, so the time of day, the sense, though I wouldn't acknowledge it, that this was over, and the panic about what do I do, you know? I really can't do anything else in my life. Paula was in, and Fifi was in. She was just very small. The three of us watched the 6 o'clock news.
The news featured a report from famine-struck Ethiopia.
Dawn, and as the sun breaks through the piercing chill of night on the plain outside Koram, it lights up a biblical famine, now in the 20th century. This place, say workers here, is the closest thing to hell on earth.
The scenes were absolutely riveting. And this, from the get-go, did not look like television. It looked like Spartacus, something vast. And it was grey, these grey wraiths moving in this grey moonscape. And the camera was pitiless. It was like a cyclops just there. It would not let you off the hook.
The Red Cross have picked out 500 mothers and children out of the thousands and are treating them in an improvised shelter. It's run by an Anglo-Swiss nurse from Hertfordshire. She has to choose who amongst the hundreds who camp outside should be let in, which babies will be saved.
Hold on, what's this guy say? What's that person doing there, that young girl in this horror, you know? What's Why does she have to decide who lives and dies?
I feel terrible because it's sending them to a certain death. It's terrible. I can take just what we can.
21 years on, the same nurse recalls her dilemma.
I tried to look at every child, but not stopping too much, because if you stop too much, they just used to throw the child at you. Or, you know, plead too much. And that was heartbreaking for me. I think I marked their forehead or their hand with a piece of charcoal, the ones we took in. And we didn't take the worst ones, because the worst ones we knew they would die.
But making that decision day after day, does that do anything to you?
Yes, of course it does. What do you expect? Yes, of course it does. It breaks my heart.
It reminded me of a Nazi in a concentration camp, sending the people to the death camp. You can come in, you're OK, you're good, you're good, you're good, but you rest, you know, you're going to die. You know, it really... That's what I remember. I remember feeling so bad about the ones I couldn't help.
By Coram standards, it wasn't a bad night. 37 dead. Tomorrow, there would be more. The day after, more still.
The context of home, here we all were. Cozy. How do I keep this going? And cozy and this? Cozy and this?
It wasn't just Bob Geldof. The whole country was shocked.
People in Britain are donating about £100,000 a day to help the famine victims.
Relief agencies who are trying to cope with the famine have been inundated today with offers of help from the public. The Save the Children Fund alone received over 1,000 calls by midday.
I was just watching that Ethiopian thing. I think this is gross after coming out after seeing that.
Oh, yeah.
I'm serious.
There are a lot of people eating a lot of food. Sorry, have you got any champagne?
Well, I've limited myself to 2 sausages as a result.
Tortured by what he'd seen, Geldof hit upon an idea to raise money the only way he could, by making a record.
Did you fucking see that thing on TV last night? Did you fucking see that? And he was on the phone and he says, "We've got to do something about it. We've really got to do something about it." I was on the phone. I just said, "Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Whatever you say, Bob."
He got lucky. He roped in his friend, songwriter and producer Midge Ure, from the chart-topping band Ultravox. To make it big, he needed big stars, but some of them were suspicious.
And Bob Conway, I thought, he's the last person in the world who'd be talking about this kind of thing.
Is that the Chimes of Doom I pulled off?
I thought he was one of the greatest rock and roll stars ever. But the idea of pasta, the plate, was not something I'd associate with him. But he has, you know, as you know, he's remarkable verbal skills, and if he doesn't get you with the poetry, the spittle isn't far behind.
It's 10:30, you lazy f***.
I was really suspicious when he first rang about Band-Aid. I was going, this is odd. Why would Geldof be doing this? There must be something in it for him.
You can't blame some of us for being mildly suspicious. Try and marry these two images of a man who cared desperately and passionately about starving people in Africa and this other big, you know, bad-tempered git who swore at everybody.
He's got this drive, this mad ambition to get this thing done.
Even further back than that, though, I think.
He's like a terrier. You know, he will not let go. And once he had been let loose and got hold of all these artists, while I'm trying to put the record together, he's getting all the artists together, running up my telephone bill, I have to tell you. We both assumed the role, you know. I was the producer. I was the guy dealing with the music. He was the guy rounding up the crowd.
There's no question, if Midge just let it all pass, that would have been the end of my involvement, and the record would not have been made without him.
Geldof and Midge Ure hope to raise £72,000 for Africa, but do they know it's Christmas surpassed their wildest dreams, making more than £8 million as it swept into the charts at number one? They set up a special trust to distribute the money.
And that was it. I thought it was all over then.
But it wasn't over. In fact, Geldof's journey was only just beginning.
I said to him, come out. We'll take you out there. I'll take you to where it's all happening. We'll have it all organised. Minimum number of days spent on it, but come and see it for yourself. Fuck off, he said.
What they said is, look, if we're to continue with this story, the editors don't want to know. It's over for them. The only story now is Geldof being in Africa.
I phoned them the next day and said, have you had a chance to rethink where you're going? Oh, fuck off. And the next day, fuck off, I would see something in the diary in the newspaper, Bob Geldof collecting money from Parlophone Records or whatever it was. Go along, Bob, fuck off. And we're on with this.
While Geldof stalled, resentment about the Band-Aid Trust was gathering in unexpected quarters.
One of the surprising sources was the other charities. They saw us as a threat. They were very concerned that money which came to us was not going to go to them. And I said to Bob, it will be essential that you can demonstrate to the press and to the public who have given you all this money that you know the money's been well spent. And the only real way of doing that is to go out with the first cargo load and make sure you go from London right into the camps so that you can see that all the aid is properly distributed.
Geldof was wavering, but there was one sticking point.
Then Bob came on to me in the office and said, I'm thinking about this, but you know there'll be no fucking pictures of me with dead babies. Because that would, you know, that's why I wanted him there. Not dead babies, but I wanted him there with, to show what was happening. I wanted him, you know, beside a baby who was stick thin and stuff like that. Anyway, he, and I won't be going unless I get that promise from you. You are a dirty dealing. You're the man that ruins people's lives. You are not going to fucking ruin my life because I've got to make a living after this. I'm not a rich man. I don't have any money. But if I'm seen milking this for me, I am finished.
He's not a missionary. He's not a charity person. It's not his world at all. And he really was very frightened of what he would see. And he didn't want to go.
It's Christmas in Ethiopia, and the arrival of the pop star's flight from London was the focus of considerable curiosity.
A reluctant Geldof agreed to go on a whistle-stop tour of Ethiopia. The 9-day trip would take him to refugee centres and feeding camps in the areas worst hit by the famine. For the rock star, life was about to change forever.
This scruffy git turned up with a pair of plimsolls, dirty pair of trousers, and I think it was the usual stripy jacket and tattered shirt, looking unwashed, with his bag slung over his shoulder, load of newspapers, and making some comment about a load of fucking journalists.
He was absolutely emphatic that this was not going to be a publicity tour, as it could easily have been. That led to... Well, certainly the photographers were very worried about this, because why were they there except to do precisely what Bob said he wasn't going to do?
The ultimate thing you can photograph as a photographer is life and death. And suddenly here was this opportunity of going to a country to cover a major story where people were dying. And as a photographer, that is one of the ultimate things you can cover. And I don't care what anybody says, but you get a buzz out of that knowing that you're going to be confronted with seeing death.
You're there watching an indeterminately aged human being. It looked like it was 2 years old, but it probably was 5 or 6 or 7, a huge distended head and eyes, saucer eyes, and flies settling on the mucus of the eyes, and they couldn't stand up, and they were listless in their mother or father's arms, and all they had to give them was a few grains of unhusked wheat, and they'd eat that, and it would be like razors in their stomach, so the child would begin to void its stomach, as well as not just the contents of the stomach. Pick up the baby, Bob.
He didn't stand any nonsense. He said, if you do that, he said, you're out. I won't talk to you. So we had to obey that directive to get cooperation with him. And I do remember filming him at one point when we were in Coram and we were looking at the refugee camp, and he knew the cameras were behind him. And he was just staring in some shock at the scenes that he was seeing, and aware too that we were behind, and he suddenly turned away and expressed for the first time during that whole trip how upset he was. But he never went near to the kids. He didn't pick them up in our presence.
But the man who once said he wanted to get rich, famous and laid, this new life was mind-blowing.
You arrive at somewhere and you look out the window and there's a guard of honour. And you're going, stop. Stop this, you know. And they all line up and they're all there, the lads are snapping to attention. So what do you do? I mean, literally, what do you do? What are you supposed to do when there's a guard of honour? So I find myself in this bizarre situation of remembering newsreels of Prince Charles or the Duke of Edinburgh or somebody looking at a guard of honour. I'll do that. I saw that in a newsreel. So you go along, you're looking at these guys who are looking at you, like these 18-year-old soldiers. They're looking, look at this scruffy cunt. With look at his filthy clothes, you know. Look at the bags on him. He hasn't shaved for a week. And look at his stupid shoes. And I'm here presenting arms to this twat. You know, but I've got to go along, like, and I wink at a couple of them, and they're kind of going, you know, and next minute there's the minister or the general beside him coming along like this, you know, and I'm going. I don't know how to convey how mad it is. Like, I'm suddenly in this mad world, so unlike anything I've ever experienced. What am I doing here?
Geldof visited the remote village of Mekelle in Tigray. The area was swamped by tens of thousands of refugees fleeing the war in the north. On average, 40 people died from starvation every day.
We looked across this vast plain and it was just covered with tent after tent, wigwam-type tents. And we were told there were over 100,000 people that had moved onto this plain. That were dying, and they didn't have the food there to feed them. They just didn't have it, and they were just going to die. And it was all kind of in a beige colour. You just couldn't take it in.
And we came upon a little boy and a little girl. The little girl was one of my nightmares. The little girl was about 3 years old. And she was looking after her brother, who was about 1 year old. And the little boy was as close to death as you can be. His eyes were almost fixed, and he had that glassy, waxy look about a child who's about to die. And she continued to wave. She was in a pitiful state herself, but she continued to wave the flies away from around her brother's eyes. And the doctor explained that the little boy was unlikely to make it, but the little girl was in slightly better condition. And we moved up about halfway down the shed. This German nurse came up, spoke to the doctor, and said to the doctor, I don't know if it makes any difference to the photographer's picture of the little boy and little girl, but the little boy has just died. So Bob looked at me, and we moved up the shed. At the top of the shed, this nurse approached us again and said to the doctor, I don't know if it's going to affect your picture, but the little girl has now died. Anyway, Bob continued to talk to the doctor, and I left, and he came and found me. I'd gone behind this truck that was parked up nearby, and I'd been sick, and it was an accumulation, but there was something just dreadful about it. And two of us, sorry.
I looked around and Kenny was bawling. And I think that moment of absolute reality just stripped away all that carapace, that hardened shell, and it got him.
So I retreated up the hill a little bit just to, you know, do some general views of the area. And then the doctor emerged from a tent about 6 yards away with Bob, walking up the top end of McKaylee Camp, and the kids were just attracted to Bob, and they ran to be alongside him and look at him, the ones who could run, there was. And I thought, shit, that's a picture. I knew Bob would go nuts when I took it.
I just let it happen because I thought that would be real, because suddenly he'd stop me. Come on, Bob, you know, we got... And suddenly there was no asking, there was no nothing. It just seemed the most natural thing in the world that this human being would take this picture. And I think that's the one and only picture.
The grueling schedule involved meetings with Ethiopian officials who didn't know what to make of the scruffy pop star.
You'd meet some kind of government official, and that was always, I suppose... Not for me to say, but possibly better groomed than Geldof was. And you know, there were one or two occasions when the ministers would come over and sort of their hands outstretched to greet me, and I'm saying, no, it's not me, it's the tramp standing there.
But the dishevelled visitor tried to clean up his sartorial act for a face-to-face meeting with the Ethiopian ruler.
He knocked on my door at the Hilton Hotel that morning and said, Chris, he said, please... have you got another pair of shoes I can borrow? And I said, well, what do you want the shoes for? He said, well, just have a look at the state of mine. And I said, yeah, I know they're pretty awful, but you must have other shoes. And he said, no, he said, the only shoes I've got are carpet slippers. So I said, well, you know, this is obviously what you've got to do, Bob. Put the carpet slippers on. And he said, you bastard. He said, I know why you want me to put carpet slippers on. He said, you're going to film it, aren't you?
Bob Geldof's own feet seemed rather vulnerable. He wore carpet slippers, his shoes having fallen apart.
I didn't want to meet these guys anyway. We could have been out in the field. Reports could have been going back to the UK. I could have been talking to the people working on the ground. I could have been getting... Said I had to do this bollocks. I didn't ask for it. And we were all starving and, you know, and I think food showed up and I was pacing and I was getting more and more worried about the meeting. Two that we were there at all and some... geezer showed up.
Bob just said, just stood there and went, and how dare you keep us fucking waiting while all these people are starving and we're not even seeing the president. We're seeing, you know, the dog's body, as it were, you know.
Okay. So I'd meet the president, I'd get out my amnesty report, because I always had the amnesty report. He is a thug. He murders 60 people a day, he tortures them. So I'd say, says here that you torture people. You know, because it's quite interesting, frankly, meeting a murderer and a torturer. I thought, this guy's a prize cunt, so I just said, you know, I think you're a cunt.
I wonder how the translator put that into Amharic.
The interpreter had stopped interpreting.
You just thought, yes.
I was eating peanuts at the time. I thought, I better eat a lot of these because when you have a jail here, they don't feed you very regularly. And I thought, God, we're in trouble.
Luckily for Geldof and his party, the insult was apparently lost in translation and the trip was drawing to a close.
I'd spent the money. I'd lived up to my responsibility by going there and the crews following me, and that kept that reported back to the Band-Aid generation, if you like. Here you are, here's the people who's will benefit from your largesse. Here's how it's been done. This is what's happening now. Thank you, everyone. Goodbye.
But Geldof was about to embark on the next phase of his strange journey.
In Ethiopia, an acute shortage of transport is still hampering the distribution of food aid. And while the supplies lie in the port, they're at the mercy of the weather.
It wasn't moving, because a cartel operated within the docks of trucks, and they were charging a ridiculous price to shift the food. And I said to someone, well, you know, there should be an alternative fleet of trucks. And they said, there isn't one. How much does that cost? About £3.5 million.
Geldof left Ethiopia, haunted by the images of the past 9 days. He'd bullied the cream of the music world and insulted an African dictator. Now he got the chance to tackle the powers that be at home.
Bob turned up looking like he'd been sleeping in the nearest park bench overnight. Unshaven, hair standing on end, looking for trouble. And Bob, before anyone could get to him to ask him why he was there, strode across the hall, and I was with him, and I said, Mrs. Thatcher, there's someone I think you'd like to meet, Bob Geldof. And she said, ah.
And she said, how do you do, you know, and all this sort of thing, and I said...
I mean, at the moment, you've got a problem with the butter mount, and you don't know how to dispose of it. To sell it to the Russians is the cheapest way.
I'm sorry, but butter doesn't do very much good in Africa.
Well, butter oil actually does. It is one of the major supplementary foods.
If you can get it.
But it is a byproduct of butter. Yes.
I was pressed up very close to her, so... She's quite small and I'm relatively tall, so I was looking down and she sort of had to go like this.
A lot is going. A lot of surface food is going. But don't
forget... The Prime Minister, there are millions dying, and that's the terrible thing.
Difficult to tell who was lecturing who.
Geldof became the people's champion.
Suddenly I was this figure, which sort of hadn't sunk in really yet. And it was seen as a big confrontation with the Prime Minister.
One of these great moments when Maggie, the great, wonderful Maggie Thatcher, was brought down to that size, because she was wrong.
That's what he did so brilliantly. He just stood up and said, this is wrong.
And still today, it's like, you know, moments cab drivers remember. I'll remember that time you told the fucking thing to fuck off. Good me, I'll fucking remember that. Well, I didn't.
At a time of great political change, the punk and the Prime Minister had more in common than anyone realised.
She lashed out with her handbag at every institution she saw, the monarchy, the old Tory party, the old Labour party, the trade unions. She was a punk.
Back then, it wasn't exactly cool to support Mrs. Thatcher.
Highest standard of living ever. Highest output, highest investment, highest retail sales, highest ownership of houses. Please, will you remember that sometime?
But secretly, many, like Geldof, admired her policies. Privatised industries ignited the share-buying dream. Council house tenants bought up their own homes. And in the city, young guns were making a killing.
There was a great deal of prosperity about, and we were seeing the beginnings, perhaps, of, was it Cortina Man in those days?
A lot more people in this country felt that they were budding capitalists. Guess what? We bought our council house, you know, paid rent for 350,000 years. We're homeowners. We actually can do it now. We've got shares.
We're all being told that to go out and make money. You know, if you're an 18-year-old kid, just make money. That's it. It's cool to be 18 and have a Porsche and wear, you know, red braces and have these new mobile phones which were the size of a backpack and stuff. That's cool, you know. I actually think it is cool.
Geldof had become a charity entrepreneur, and Mrs. Thatcher loved entrepreneurs.
I think what they were doing was almost a sort of privatisation of aid. It was very much a return to a sort of 19th century idea of philanthropy and of people spontaneously taking an initiative to help other people rather than relying on or expecting the state to do it for them. We are
the world. Even in the home of capitalism, the cream of America's music talent was jumping on Geldof's bandwagon. 45 top stars were about to record their own charity single for the famine.
I was quite moved by the fact that a bunch of Brits got together, you know, and decided to do this. I think that's what really kind of woke us all up in America. There comes a
time. The two superstars of the moment, Lionel Richie and Michael Jackson, wrote the song, and Richie's manager, Ken Cragen, invited Geldof to come to Los Angeles for the recording.
Well, I'd never spoken to Bob Geldof before. I didn't really know what I was in for.
At the Band-Aid recording in London, the talent had gone to the local chippy for their dinner. But in California, they did things differently.
I got, I don't know, $50,000 worth of free food donated for the group and for, and it was all spread out.
It was in Hollywood, California. So when you say, would any restaurant like to cater for free? Well, it's only gonna be Spago's, it's only gonna be Chasen's, and their presentation is going to be over the top.
Geldof was not impressed.
The only problem with that is Bob walked in, saw it, and started berating the people for eating while the people were dying in Africa.
It was a little egregious, like, you know, I think the caviar, the lavishness of it.
It was a little embarrassing. I had to go retrieve Bob and get him back to the studio.
We Are the World raised $45 million across the globe, four times as much as Band-Aid.
They'll always say to you, oh, you're the guy who did We Are the World, and I go, no, you know. But, you know, whenever I walk into a bloody room in Africa, we are the world. No, wrong song.
The money-making potential of a huge gathering of top-class talent would stay with Geldof. 2 months before, he'd been written off as a fading star, hell-bent on his own publicity. Now, he was the man on a mission, the conscience of the nation.
They started to call him Saint Bob.
He slipped from kind of, you know, the rock star persona into the Saint Bob persona very easily.
They stopped calling him a musician or a singer. They always referred to him regarding his charity work rather than his musical work, and that was kind of sad because we were still a band, we were still a working band.
People would come up and, hello Bob, how are you? How's it going? Is everyone okay over there now? How's it all going? And would thrust money at him, and rings and everything.
I wanted this to stop now. I mean, it was already beyond any control I had.
So, ladies and gentlemen, for tonight's special award, Bob Geldof and Midgeur, please come forward.
But Geldof was the face and the voice of Band-Aid and the story everyone wanted. And his unique force of character came at a cost to those close to him.
He was awful in these award ceremonies. He would literally just go and get the award, say, thanks so much, don't know where I'd be without you, you know, you've saved people, thanks so much, bye. Leaving Midge with no award and nothing to just stand there going,
And Midgeur!
We both went up to pick up the award, and Bob, in his usual manner, launched into this huge speech.
I'll say something.
Leaving me standing behind them again, and, you know, 3 feet behind them, looking a bit kind of dazed and confused.
Why wouldn't he want Midge to share the awards and the glory and the credit for doing what they did? Why does the rest of the world think it's just Bob's baby? Why did Bob allow that to happen?
It was a classic Geldof, you know, he doesn't mean it, it's just... He's there, and he was launching at this big thing about the whole Band-Aid, Live Aid thing and whatever, but it's just how he is.
He had the awards and he had the acclaim, but old suspicions began to resurface. Some reporters were openly hostile.
Fortuitously, but not by design, the success of Geldof and Band-Aid has brought new life to the sagging popularity of the Boomtown Rats. It has earned the group criticism that they're cashing in on Geldof's Ethiopian philanthropy, even that his obsession with fundraising has become sanctimonious.
Thing is that if they say, oh, what a publicity stunt, I mean, it is frankly ridiculous. I don't work 20 hours a day on publicity stunts.
Tonight, the Rats will hold a concert in London and can reflect that while they never planned it, the ill wind from Africa has certainly done them some good.
But had it, the rest of the Rats certainly didn't think so.
Suddenly on this tour, 80-year-old ladies were coming up and says, hiya, Bob, here's £20. It was good, but it was strange, you know. We're trying to be a rock and roll band, you know. We don't want your mum to like us.
That tour was wildly different because the old Buckets would have gone around, or they were at the exit. So, like, you know, we come in and everyone's job... I mean, so I promise you, in the band, we'd have to divvy up the Buckets and count the money.
The Band Aid Buckets raised £50,000, much more than the band was making on its record sales.
We would leave the venue, get on the tour bus, all the Buckets would be piled onto the tour bus and they'd be down the centre aisle. And rather than the usual sort of rock and roll, like Jack Daniels and telling wild stories, we'd all be there counting. That's another £500. You count the coins. And the whole band would be sitting there till about 2 o'clock in the morning, counting all this money. And this would happen every night.
Pathetic, you know. Where were the babes? You know, why didn't they count them? You know, it didn't happen.
I was a Boomtown Rats fan. Yeah, I really, really liked them as a band. And in fact, I saw the Boomtown Rats at university and was annoyed at how many thousands of people wanted to get in to see them, because I had been a fan. But of course, people were there to worship at the shrine of St. Bob, and rightly so. Rightly so, he'd done such an incredible thing. But I was annoyed, because I'd been there at the beginning.
It was the end of the road for the Rats, and Geldof bowed to the inevitable. Since his visit there, Ethiopia had never been far from his thoughts. Now he had a brainwave.
Bob came in one day and said, look, we have to break this trucking cartel, but we haven't got enough money. And we all kind of went, oh, OK. He said, I've got this idea.
We were going to do a concert. Now, Bob, in his way, this wasn't a consultation with the trustees. This was a statement of fact. This was going to happen. And I think we all were scared.
We all sat there kind of going, huh?
But Geldof couldn't do it alone. He needed someone as bulgy as himself to get the job done. Harvey Goldsmith was the biggest promoter of the day. What's more, this tough music industry bruiser had the mouth to match Geldof's own.
I actually basically told him to fuck off at first because I just thought he was being ridiculous.
I mean, he actually did say, you're fucking mad.
But Geldof wouldn't take no for an answer.
The phone rang. And there he was, saying, got to see you today, got to get this concert together. And I said, I'm just unpacking, I've just got off the plane from China, I don't know where I am, let's talk tomorrow. Got in the office, I think I've been there about 6 minutes, phone rang, Bob again. I said, OK, let's meet. To do a big concert at Wembley, lots of big acts, and rattled off the A to Z of that time, every major act there was, and said they're all doing it. And I just looked at him and said, yeah, very funny.
And he says, what do you mean, one concert, two continents? Why do you do that?
Basically, everything he said he wanted to do, I said, you can't. So we went, that was our starting point.
It's a nightmare you're going to have in the middle of the summer. They're already booked up. But, like, he kept saying, and then what are you going to do then? And then what? And you could see he kept asking a question.
In the back of my mind, I actually knew it was possible, but I didn't want to tell him that.
We're scared of Bob.
We're scared of Geldof.
Now he just needed the talent. And for them, there was no safe hiding place.
And he just approached me in the middle of Heathrow Airport. I don't think he was going anywhere. I think he was just sort of there haranguing people, scared the crap out of me. So I said yes.
And he was so angry and committed and very, you know, volatile. And so I just went along with it. You know, you don't say no to Bob Geldof very easily.
We're scared of Bob!
What did you say to Bob? No? Do you know anyone that said no to Bob?
You don't say no to Bob. I thought it was such a great idea that, of course, I said yes immediately.
But not everyone saw it as a golden opportunity.
When he said to me what he was trying to do, I burst out laughing. I said, don't be ridiculous.
I must admit, when they told me about it, I thought, what a terrible idea.
I thought, God, a big gathering of all those whalers. And it was the 80s, remember, there was so much crap around. And I thought, oh, God, it'll be all them, you know, all pouncing around in their white trousers.
So you'd say, oh, well, it's in July sometime. Not quite sure where it's going to be. Don't know if it'd be on the telly. And by the way, you can only probably play for about 20 minutes. You won't get a contract, but we want you on the TV. And you have to pay for it all yourselves. And it was like, fuck off.
And as if that wasn't enough, Geldof was to boldly go where no man or television station had gone before. An all-day transatlantic live TV extravaganza when satellite technology was still in its infancy. Only one man could make it work. Geldof flew to New York to see Mike Mitchell, who had just produced the television coverage of the LA Olympics.
He and I discussed what it is that he wanted to accomplish. And when I went there, I was very skeptical. He had originally wanted to do a concert between London and New York. I had just come off the Games and said I really wasn't interested in that, but if he wanted to do a worldwide event, I'm in.
They called it the Global Jukebox, and it was getting bigger by the minute. Wembley would start at noon. America would join in 5 hours later. The shows would be beamed all around the world via satellite, with other countries joining in. It was a round-the-clock operation.
I took my little house, and we moved in desks, and we ordered more telephone lines, and we simply just worked out of that house for the show. And I couldn't even go to the bathroom during the day. That's how bad it was.
America was the leading expert in the satellite technology that Geldof needed for the Global Jukebox. So everything hinged on getting the American show right. Harvey Goldsmith pinned his hopes on the legendary West Coast promoter, Bill Graham.
Bill Graham was an irascible, angry, difficult control freak, and you either did it his way or you didn't. He also was an amazingly creative guy, and he really put music on the map in America.
You know, Bill, it was an imposing figure. He always ruled by intimidation. He was as tough a promoter as has ever been produced on the history of the planet, I would imagine. You know, he was a bad motherfucker.
Graham's sidekick and fall guy was fellow promoter Larry Magid.
Everything about Bill was drama. You knew that there was going to be a timed explosion at some point, and it became part of the ritual with Bill.
So far, Geldof and Goldsmith had few stars on board, no venue in America, or even at that point a broadcaster in either country. All they had was the bluff of Bob.
And then they could say, great, we took part in the biggest TV broadcast ever, now f*** off.
One of the very early impossibilities that Bob threw at me was that he wanted to put this out on TV. And he then said, I want the whole concert on TV. And I said, that ain't gonna happen.
There was only one organisation that could pull it off. Good old Ante.
You simply couldn't believe that you'd bring together Queen, U2, Paul McCartney, you name it. I mean, you know, Rod Stewart, yes, he'll be there too. Phil Collins, oh, he'll be in Concord. All this was sort of, it was being told me, and I was sort of saying, yes, that's all, you know, that's really interesting. But I didn't believe it, to be honest.
Bob thumped the table and said, no, I want the whole show out, all 12 hours of it, and we're going to do America, so I want that out as well. I want the whole day sorted out, and he just stormed out the room.
I just assumed they would. So why not? And I suppose it's sort of that naivete. It didn't strike me as that big a deal.
And then suddenly, Bob walked in the door again, and he said, I want an answer by Tuesday. He shot out the door.
I've been having second thoughts about this, and I'd like to hear more from the music department about the idea.
Well, what exactly do you want?
Well, it'll be mainly music, George.
Well, frankly, to me, this savours too much of a gimmick. I'm in favour of the experiment.
For 2 weeks, Geldof and Goldsmith held their breath. Then finally, a breakthrough.
I called Bob and said, I just had a call from Roger and he thinks he might be doing it. He said, good, is he going to do the whole lot? OK wasn't good enough. It was the whole ball of works or nothing.
With only 6 weeks to go before transmission, the news was broken to BBC staff.
Bearing in mind it was the height of the summer and most of the outside broadcast vehicles were already booked for other things, you've got all sorts of sporting activities going on. Just, I thought, it's going to be an absolute nightmare.
The biggest misgivings were voiced by the team who had the unenviable task of presenting the show. The men behind the Anorak's favourite music programme from the late-night graveyard slot, The Whistle Test.
I was on holiday, in fact, and I remember putting down the telephone and going out and lying in the meadow outside the house and staring up at the sky and just feeling nauseous with terror.
The thing you have to remember about Whistle Test is that we were a very humble little programme. We were 40 minutes once a week occasionally on BBC Two. And here we were doing one of the biggest shows the BBC had ever done. It was like asking BBC Radio Cleck Heaton to do the Olympic Games. You know, we really weren't up to it.
If that wasn't enough of a problem, the new boy on the show was ideologically opposed to the whole thing.
I could see that whilst it was a worthy gesture by a number of pop stars, there had to be behind it something more substantial to back it up. I wanted the governments to do something about it. They're the people who had the real power.
Geldof had his work cut out, getting the European networks on board.
I talked to them from the very beginning about this, and the precondition for any of the wealthier Western countries is that they run a telethon. Iceland don't want to do a telethon.
Geldof's global jukebox dream wasn't going to plan. America's can-do culture was rapidly becoming can't-do. The nation that put a man on the moon didn't believe that this show was technically possible.
We were literally laughed out of all three networks' offices. The Olympics, we used two satellites, one feed, one location to a world feed. Live Aid, 16 satellites, 8 locations, all interactive feed for 16 hours. In today's terms, it would be like saying, let's do a concert on the moon.
After weeks of wrangling, ABC finally agreed to broadcast not the whole day, but a 3-hour special with Philadelphia as the American venue. They had the venues and the TV networks, but few stars confirmed. Geldof and Goldsmith had no choice. They had to go public.
We had a press conference at Wembley to announce the whole thing, which was a bit of a farce, really, because we actually didn't have anybody confirmed at that point at all.
We were scribbling names down as Bob was going, because we had to go at 12 o'clock, I seem to remember, on Radio 1.
Richard Skinner here talking to you live from Wembley Stadium, where a very important announcement is about to be made.
Good morning, everybody. I'm very pleased to announce today that as Band-Aid's first part of their relief programme comes to an end, and as our younger sister, USA for Africa, begin their relief programme today, Band-Aid start the second part of their programme by announcing Live Aid. The people taking part in alphabetical order will be Brian Adams, Adam Ant, the Boomtown Rats, David Bowie, the Cars.
Most of the press conference was spent with bits of paper flying about from various different people, to Bob, back to Bob, to Bernard and so on. and from me saying, no, this act hasn't confirmed, and he would just be flicking them off the table.
I would have been flicking it away because it would have been a distraction, because it was going to happen. It was going to happen that Mick was going to somehow square things with Keith, and that was all going to happen, and Bob Dylan was going to show up, and it was going to be wonderful. That was in my head. There wasn't a second's doubt as I did it, but afterwards I'd be sick with fear.
Queen's Shade, manager, Santana, Jim Beach, suddenly Simon, interrupted the proceedings.
Minds, Spandau Ballet.
I suddenly got yanked out. It was Jim Beach calling from New Zealand. And he said, what the hell is this all about? He said, why are you announcing Queen? I said, because Bob told me they were doing it. And he said, what? So I said, look, we're right in the middle of the press conference. He said, you better not announce Queen. I coughed a bit and said, because he'd already done it.
The Pretenders, Queen.
Bands who were no longer together were amazed to hear they were reforming, especially for Live Aid.
Status quo.
I got a call from Pete Townsend just as they were going into the press conference that I thought sort of intimated to me that he was at least interested in playing. Not with the Who, but he was interested in playing.
Marsha came in with her bit of paper to say that Pete Townsend agreed to do it. Threw it at Bob. Bob read it and announced that the Who were getting back together again.
And about 5 minutes ago, we heard some wonderful news, and that is that the Who, one of the greatest bands ever in rock music, are reforming specifically for this event.
What the fuck are you talking about? It was just really bizarre. It was really, really bizarre.
The phones light up completely mentally from the pair of them. What the fuck do you think you're doing? I don't even speak to him. I'm not going to do it.
I think you will agree that we have more or less, without a doubt, in fact, the most important people over the last 20 years. And I can also tell you that the remaining half dozen or so huge bands in the world are at the moment trying to clear their desks, and we will let you know over the next 3 weeks who's in and who's out of that remaining half dozen.
I went through the list, and like literally the journalists were sort of gasping, have you got so-and-so? Yes, yes. And they were kind of freaking out. And it's Brian Ferry, so-and-so. Next month, like the phone rang about 2 hours later, as Brian said, I never agreed to do it. And I said, well, hey, dude, you know, pull out.
As the Wembley press conference made clear, Geldof's brusque, domineering personality was driving Live Aid forward while pushing old friends aside.
It was becoming very obvious that Midge was being pushed into the background. So Bob said, OK, then, well, I'll read one band out and Midge can read the other, and so on and so on.
Richard Skinner here talking to you live from Wembley Stadium, where a very important...
I tuned into Radio 1 all sort of excited that at last Midge was going to get, you know, his due for doing so much work and get to be a part of things again. And I sat and Bob just did the whole... It was as if Midge wasn't there.
On two continents... I'll read out the list of people taking part.
The conference kicked off without me. I felt a bit miffed. I was a bit left out. I was standing talking to Gary Kemp and Adam Ant. Before I knew it, a kind of partition had been closed and the press launch was happening next door. So there's the entire Band-Aid trustees all sitting there with Bob spouting off about who he was going to get. And I was in with them and I'm thinking, hold on a second, what's happened to me? Where have I gone?
Well, I mean, he had nothing to do with Live Aid. I mean, that's it. That's the reality of it. And I would have said, well, if he wants to do something, he can, but it was never suggested to me, and I would have thought it redundant, really.
I know it's not about egos and it's not about personalities, but I think it was quite hard for Midge to take. And to his credit, he never said anything publicly.
Despite bruised egos behind the scenes, all pop fans cared about was that the biggest concert in history was going to happen in just 4 weeks.
The people taking part in alphabetical order will be Brian Adams, Adam Ant, the Boomtown Rats.
I'm just waiting for the K's to come along, and it said Nick Kershaw, and I'm there.
Judas Priest, Nick Kershaw, Chris Christopherson, Huey Lewis and the News.
I mean, I wouldn't go if it was just the Wurzels, and it was the Wurzels and Bucks Fizz, I wouldn't bother.
Coming here for the music or for the charity?
For charity and the music. It was a thrill to be able to go back to the Polytechnic and go in with this ticket and say, we've got one, we've got one, we've got one.
I stayed on the phone for hours while it was engaged, like about 4 hours, just ringing, putting it down, ringing, putting it down.
I got through after 4 hours, that's all it took, with my mum's credit card.
That's right.
God bless her.
The tickets sold out in minutes, but one fruit and veg seller in Cheshire decided to do something a bit more ambitious.
The Live Aid concert will be the biggest televised event the world has ever seen. Now, in Wembley Stadium, there'll be two giant television screens, which will be receiving the American end of the concert live by satellite. There's only one other vast television screen, mobile, in the country, and that won't be at any stadium. No, that'll be right here, in this field, at Pot Shrigley, near Bollington, in Cheshire.
I've got the biggest screen in Europe, this bloody big screen, and nowhere to put it. And Ches Orme, local lad, local farmer, he said, do it on my field. And it went from like a small little idea to something quite large, really.
Geldof had the date, the venues, the satellites, and now the audience, but still, no lineup.
You would think now, looking back, the greatest show on earth. Every artist in the world must have clamoured to play that, to play at Live Aid. That wasn't the case whatsoever. It was the exact opposite. There were many, many artists who need a great deal of convincing and managers who were sceptical that it would take place and it would be first class and it would show their artist in a good light and that it was real, that it would actually take place. And so Bob would use bluff and bluster and outright porky pies. He'd phone one artist, for example, he'd phone Elton and say, Queen and Bowie are in. And then he'd phone Bowie and say, Elton and Queen are in. And they weren't in. He was making it up.
The best way is to make them feel threatened by their peers. So it gets to the point, if you're not on it, well then, who are you in the hierarchy? So if you've got Paul McCartney, Mick Jagger, David Bowie, Bob Dylan, who the fuck are you that you're not doing it?
For bands who had split up, like Status Quo, Geldof played the role of marriage counsellor.
He said, nobody's interested in doing it, you can't get anybody to... And he said, we're not happening, we're unrehearsed, and he said, it doesn't matter a fuck what you sound like, as long as you're there. He could have said, we really need you guys, you're great, but he didn't.
Live Aid still needed the supergroups of the age. Suddenly, a breakthrough.
I simply looked down at my date sheet and I noticed that we were playing a 12-night run at Wembley Arena across that period. And when he said the date was July the 13th, 1985, I noticed that we were playing at Wembley Arena on July the 13th, 1985. And I literally said to him, well, we'll just walk across, which is what we did, and we'll do the performance. And then as long as we can have a time slot where we can get back to play to the 12,000 odd people who I hoped at that point were going to buy tickets for our show.
The only thing I do remember thinking was whether in fact we'd be able to get it done in time and not to be able to get back and do the other gig.
Several other managers subsequently rang me and said, are you doing this show at Wembley? Do you think X should do it?
It was an accident of timing that proved a critical breakthrough.
Ringing for you.
People actually started calling up and saying, well, you know, we're doing the show, we'd like to be on at 6 o'clock, right? Well, I said, okay, but you're doing the show bit's good enough, right? Could we just do the billing bit later? And of course, you know, Radio Bicknell had told everybody what time he was on, right? So they're all scrabbling now, because well, naturally you're a manager and you say, my ex got to do this thing, you know. What's the next thing? You want to get the best bit on the bill.
Before Dire Straits said yes, bands would do anything to get out of doing Live Aid. Now, there was a mad rush to get in.
Are we on while America is watching? You know, that was probably a question coming from my office to the promoters and to Geldof as to what time of the day we went on. There was a bit of jostling that went on during the run-up to the show.
No, I wanted to do it, you know, because it was an important thing to do.
I remember at the time it was really frowned on if you said, oh, it would be good for our career. So no one ever kind of mentioned that anyway. It was all kept kind of underneath.
You knew how important it would be. Not just for the cause, but for your own career.
I've read some criticism about people saying, well, they just did it because they wanted publicity. None of us needed publicity.
It's not a lie, you know, you think things... It's a wonderful cause, and it was a wonderful day for the music business, but don't tell me there was one act there that wasn't aware that there would be more than a billion people watching. Yes, I'm lucky,
yes, I'm lucky! But Geldof's idol, Mick Jagger, still hadn't taken the bait, even though Geldof had been stalking him for weeks.
And all that. So he said it'll be a nightmare, he said, but, you know, I'll do it.
Mick Jagger agreed to perform in America without the Stones, but then he and his mate David Bowie had another brainwave, a transatlantic duet.
At one point, I was going to do my part of the song in England, and Jagger was going to be in the States doing his part over there.
I said, how do we do that? He's in a, you know, you're in America, he's here.
But we couldn't find anybody who was fully convinced that we could actually sing at the same time and make it work everywhere. So we abandoned that idea anyway.
He said, well, can't we do something with a spaceship? And there was this whole argument going on about which of them was going to be sitting in the rocket singing. I actually made a call to NASA. Say, have you got any rockets going up? We'd like one to put Mick Jagger on. And I could imagine and go, who's this nutcase? What?
The space shuttle was abandoned in favour of something more down to earth.
I genuinely didn't know that they were going to go off to a studio and do Dancing in the Street, which is, you know, so apt. And then knocked off a video, you know, which is hilarious. These two sort of old queens trying to outcamp each other, really. And it went to number one, and the money came to us.
As the cast list got longer, the tabloids lapped up every detail. But the serious music fans' bible remained more po-faced.
The NME was really steeped in what we'd now call an indie kind of attitude, in which anything to do with the mainstream is probably bad. Anything that is deeply unpopular is probably good. Live Aid was perhaps the most mainstream event which any of us had ever seen, actually, in our lives. And it was therefore hardly a very cool thing to attach one's self to. Don't you?
The black press was even more critical, furious at what it saw as the deliberate exclusion of black British artists. The Voice newspaper called it the Band-Aid blacklist.
You know, yet again, somehow we weren't part of what was going on in the country. You know, of course a lot of people felt pissed off, a lot of people felt as though, you know, fuck you, you know, here it goes again.
Because this was a concert for famine relief in Africa, perhaps one or two Africans, maybe valid and valuable additions to the lineup. Oh, no. Can't have any of that.
A journalist who suggests there should be more black performers on the bill at Wembley gets short shrift.
Thanks, mate. We don't need someone to pull a crowd. We need to get money to stop people dying. People, and I don't care if they're orange, luminous pink or green. The object is to stop people dying.
Political correctness, thank God, wasn't that terrible at that time. So we didn't have to have a one-legged lesbian and all the rest of it. You know, we were just putting a show together.
Geldof did want the black American stars of We Are the World, but most of them didn't want to know.
We went to all of the major black acts who were popular at that time, and they all said no. But we couldn't explain that to people. I mean, we had this unbelievable discussion with Michael Jackson's people saying this is to help people in Africa. It just wasn't interested.
In America, there was an agenda that was in a way bought from their Band-Aid record of that community of black acts committing or not. And it was like a block vote. Unfortunately, the block vote sort of went against the Philadelphia show from the black artist community.
The Wembley concert was finally falling into place. The that the all-important American end was falling apart.
After lunch, bad news. Da-da-da-da. Promoter Harvey Goldsmith has received a 4-foot-long telex from the American organizers of the Philadelphia concert.
With just 3 weeks to go, there were few confirmed acts in the American bill, and the erratic promoter Bill Graham had stopped returning Geldof's calls.
America was horrendous, and I was in a complete panic. I wouldn't show it, but like I really did not sleep about America because we weren't kept in touch, and you know, and Harvey and I went there, and it was a mess. I mean, it was a mess when we went into the office, and Bill Graham was rude and superior and very distracted.
Bob thought Graham would go out and secure performers, and that's not what he did. We put a team together. We literally picked up the phone and just started calling people, and Graham wasn't really participating in that.
Rumors now reached London that Graham was actively undermining the show he was supposed to be promoting.
We were hearing from some artists that he was telling them behind our backs that the show wouldn't take place and that it wasn't well organized and they shouldn't participate and it would damage their careers. And he, in fact, put some artists off.
Paul Simon pulled out because of Bill Graham's behavior, and Paul called me. I can't do it, man. I'm not on a star thing, he said, but I just can't put up with this behavior, you know, from Graham. He's just rude and insulting. So I was going...
America was rapidly slipping down the drain. Without the US show, there would be no satellite link-up and no global event. Goldsmith's sidekick, Pete Smith, was sent to America to whip Bill Graham's ass.
He said, this show can't happen. And he said, do you see all those bits of paper on my desk? I said, yeah, I've been looking at those. He said, well, those are all of the artists, you know, that could play at Philadelphia, you know, the American artists. And I said, so? He said, I refuse to work with half of these people. He's quite a bullish guy. Right? So me being the optimist, I said to him, well, there's a lot of bits of paper. What about the other half? And he looked at me and said, they refuse to work with me.
It wasn't just the stars who had a problem with Bill Graham. His relationship with the TV producers reached crisis point.
The television people would come in and they would have a little meeting with us, and it would always end in Bill yelling at them.
He was doing a concert and we were doing a television show. So there was a conflict, and his personality is such, he's theatrical, he's dramatic, and so we didn't work together well.
It didn't resolve itself. They hated each other. I got custody of Bill.
Geldof and Goldsmith threatened to sack Bill Graham.
I was piggy in the middle. That's exactly what I was. I was right smack in the middle, and there wasn't anything to do but keep these two people from killing each other.
And as if all this bad blood wasn't enough, chart-topping band Huey Lewis and the News suddenly pulled out.
Mysteriously, we would get withdrawals. And that's when we dug into it and found, as I said, there were interest groups who were calling artists, actually telling them not to participate.
So far, a few stars from the record We Are the World had come on board.
In a nutshell, they didn't want to be superseded, I don't think, USA for Africa, by something they thought was, in effect, a Band-Aid enterprise.
It looked like it would be a chaotic disaster.
There was a spin put out that that's what was going on. You're either being used, or people are going to make a lot of money off you, or it's not going to happen. And so there was this game played for about 4 to 5 weeks, up until literally the week or so before the event, of people in or out.
Back in Britain, Geldof's lineup was almost complete. But as usual, he wanted more. One of the icons of the age, Princess Diana. There must be an angel
playing with my heart, yeah. Tonight, the Prince and Princess arrived back in London to attend a concert by the pop group Dire Straits. Tonight's performance is being given in aid of the Prince's Trust, a charity particularly associated with the royal couple.
Geldof managed to get a free ticket from somebody, because he certainly wouldn't pay, and showed up and kind of corralled them in the corner and talked them into coming along to at least the opening of the Live Aid show.
I thought it would be important that they came because at that time, you know, it was glamorous, there was the excitement around their relationship and stuff like that. And they represented, well, the country.
He had royalty, and now Geldof wanted pop royalty. But the king of pop, Paul McCartney, was still holding out. The former Beatle hadn't performed live since John Lennon's death 5 years earlier.
He was an artistic recluse. He hadn't played, hadn't performed anywhere. He was having his family life. And Bob needed him badly for credibility. You know, one of the Beatles had to be in the show.
Pete Smith and production manager Andrew Zweck were told to go to McCartney's offices, as Geldof put it, to bag the lion.
There was a real sense of apprehension. You know, Friday night, 5 o'clock, you know, go get Paul McCartney.
So we all marched over to the office in Soho Square, very important, to discuss how the show was going to work. I was panicking. I had no idea how the show was going to work. And I was called upon to be the spokesman of how it was all going to be perfect and wonderful and technically professional and enhance Paul's career and he'd play in a fantastic light. But I was making it up, is the truth of it.
What if we go out there, you know, into Soho Square at 6 o'clock and he's said no, you know? I suppose you'd catch a train to Dover or something, you know? Because I'm not going back to see Harvey or Bob. But at the end of the meeting, he said, I was always going to do this show. You know? And I said, well, you know, why are you always going to do it? And he said, the management. So I said, Stephen Shrimpton, your manager? He said, no, Pete, said, the management. So I thought, Linda? You know, so I said to him, oh, he said, who do you think the management is? And I said, the kids?
My kids were very keen on the whole thing. One or two of them were a little too small to be aware of it. But I think the thing about Live Aid was everyone who could be aware, who was conscious, was aware of it. It galvanised the nation.
With the last act in place, Andrew Zweck was finally free to concentrate on the greatest show on earth.
We sat there on the Sunday in an empty stadium and sheer unadulterated panic set in. We had been neglecting this show and suddenly it dawned on us, how were we going to pull it off? How were we going to put on 25 bands on a strict timetable in a very limited physical space?
We're out of power in this stadium. We're drawing every amp that we've got here. We're fresh out of power. This is what Wembley Stadium have come this morning. They've said our plans to light the audience and so on. There's not an amp left in the place.
But can we just get more generators in?
Well, I've already got three out there. I'm already at three generators.
Get more, Andy, get more.
I remember panicking in the very start of the week with Bob telling him, we haven't got enough of anything. There's not enough power here. We don't have the physical size to put all the bands on. There's no room to put all the artists. We haven't got enough catering. I haven't got enough staff. Where am I going to get it?
We're getting too big and spectacular. The resources are drying up.
Zweck's most pressing problem was another of Geldof's brainwaves, a revolving stage.
This is stage 1, 2, and 3. The reason it has to be like this is that it's unlike other pop shows. It's not when you go on, it's when you come off. Every band gets 20 minutes. We have to do that to fit in the appeal for money twice on the hour.
He knew it from some industrial trade show, which had abandoned it because it didn't work. But it was this large revolving turntable, very, very heavy, very unsuited for this purpose. We were absolutely flying by the seat of our pants. Once it was installed, it kept malfunctioning and it kept sinking into the wood because of its weight.
I
think my only concern was always whether this bloody stage would get stuck or not. And I said at the end of the day, if it doesn't work, you better get some horses in. What I meant was you better get to get lots and lots of people to physically turn the thing round.
I was going, you must be fucking joking, you know, underneath the bloody stage, you know.
Well, this was utter rubbish. Soon became a myth, because there was no room under that stage, even for a rat.
The horse was a big possibility. He was there, wasn't he?
If the stagehands were a bit clapped out, over at the BBC, things didn't seem much better.
SIO, EP781.
It was like the 1940s. If they'd all pipes, it would have been perfect. They had a blackboard, and they'd drawn these little dots. Now, Sat 1 will go from here, and there'll be these guys with beards and sort of sandals writing things down. At 400, we'd be there. And it really was like that, like a war room.
Give me station's booking, please.
They presented this running order, and we laughed. We burst out laughing. They said at 1702, Sade would take the stage, and at 1917, the Who would come off. And we said, this is not how the music business works. This is not rock and roll. You're not going to tell the Who they have to leave the stage. You're not going to tell these artists what to do. And we laughed at the BBC.
With only days to go, America was still unravelling. Geldof badly needed the artists from We Are The World to give the show global credibility. A showdown took place between Ken Cragen, Mike Mitchell and Harvey Goldsmith.
We actually ended up all meeting together because there was a point where we suddenly felt we were being competitive. And I just wanted to get that out of the way really fast because that's the last thing we needed. It just wasn't on the agenda. So we had to sort out with them what they were trying to do because they were going to try to do their own concert.
With only 3 days to go, Ken Cragen struck a last-minute deal to appease the artists who were still holding out.
So when I got the call saying we're in, I sort of heaved a sigh of relief too, because the stories would have been, where were they, rift between and all that stuff.
America was finally falling into place, but at Wembley, a massive row was brewing. Everyone in Britain was giving their services for free, except Wembley, who insisted on charging for the venue and their staff.
Wembley were the biggest pains in the arse of the whole thing. They were really not going with the plot. They wanted money, they wanted this, they wanted that. And, like, I was just going, fuck them, you know? No.
An 11th-hour meeting was arranged with Wembley's deputy chairman, Jarvis Astaire.
Suddenly, Bob Geldof let it rip and used a number of four-letter words.
Jarvis was starting to really dig his heels in, and the more he was digging his heels in, the more Bob was swearing, and the more Jarvis was getting seriously upset.
That man Geldof has just sworn at me then. And I said, so you've never met Bob before then? And he said, I'm not having it. I'm not having it in my boardroom.
I was, to some extent, offended that he was in the boardroom at Wembley having a proper business meeting, and he was behaving like the wild ruffian that I thought he was in the first place.
It actually got very close to blows as it happened.
And I said to him, if you want to talk to me about an event at Wembley and you're here, don't use that language and don't bang on the table.
And at that point, he was it was like, I'm not having this, I'm not having this show in here, I'm not having that man in here. And we all thought it was all off again.
At the 24th hour, Wembley reached a deal. Live Aid agreed to pay the stadium £250,000 for the day. It wasn't just the big guns. In Cheshire, fruit and veg man Tony Butterworth was having his own battle with bureaucracy.
The main stumbling blocks were actually Macclesfield Borough Council, if I'm telling the truth, you know, because they really didn't want it to be around here. They were absolutely sure that the hippie convoy was going to arrive from Stonehenge, you know, and there's going to be dirt, dust and other unsavoury activities. We had to go the following day to the town hall, and the place was full of people objecting, and there was an old lady. She looked like Mrs. Marples, you know, big coat on and a portmanteau. And and she was sat right at the back, and I kept turning around and looking at her, like, you know, and I thought, ooh, she's trouble. Anyway, it came to the end of the sort of summing up, and this old woman at the back stuck her hand up, you know, and I thought, oh, this is it. And she said, I just want to say there are people dying right now as we speak. And she picked her bag up and went, and she walked past me and went. And these three judges said, there's your licence, you know.
One day to go, and the stars were wheeled out onto the BBC to promote the show. While along the corridor, the foot soldiers were receiving their marching orders.
We were given no guidance at all about the kind of programme that was wanted. We didn't know whether we were covering an event or participating in it.
Absolutely no preparation and absolutely no rehearsal at all. I mean, I can remember being called to a meeting, but mostly it was just lots of technical johnnies from the kind of outside broadcasting, talking about, you know, miles of cables that they were going to use and satellite links and all sorts of rather butch-sounding technology. We were kind of just gibbering in the middle of it.
We were all given little folders with the running order and show up. That's all you could do, show up.
It was as amateur and as shambolic as that.
But one man was more than relieved to see the BBC vans roll into Wembley.
BBC marching with their clipboards, and they've got this running order, and they said, this is how it's going to be. It's all going to work like clockwork. We're going to interface with Philadelphia. And I thought, well, I believe them now. You know, in the beginning, I thought this was pie in the sky. But once they arrived on site, team-handed with all of the staff and all of the clipboards and all of the equipment, I thought, hang on, I'm not alone here.
Then the time came to try out the stage.
The one dry run we got, because time was running out, it did fail, and panic set in, and then we called in volunteers. We called everybody we could find on it. Please come and help.
It was completely like Keystone Cops. You had big, burly men running around with amps, getting stuck in the middle of the stage turning, people still trying to plug amps in, wires all crossed, things falling over.
Is that the familiar face of Janice Lark? Janice, how's it going?
Things are going really well down here at Wembley. We've just missed...
I remember having to be... Well, lying, basically, to Terry, you know, no, it's all fine, it's all going to be hunky-dory. You could feel the panic, because there was no way that stage was going to go anywhere.
We panicked, as usual.
It would be a long night for Bob Geldof. At 2 o'clock in the morning, he was awoken by a phone call. U2 wanted to pull out of the show.
We probably threw a wobbler, because we weren't getting a sound check. That would be very like us.
Yeah. I don't remember that.
I do remember trouble like over this? A sound check, yeah.
Geldof, by now exhausted after weeks of sleepless nights, spat out his familiar response.
Fuck 'em.
Stay right here. Part 2, coming up next.
Africa Lives on the BBC.
After 12 manic weeks of bluffing, backstabbing, superstar egos, and transatlantic rivalry, Live Aid Day finally dawned. Everyone was on tenterhooks. Television was still in the Stone Age, and no one had ever done anything like this before. 58 bands, live over 16 hours, with a temperamental revolving stage and 13 satellites. Would it work? Would anyone watch? And more importantly, would the punters put their hands in their pockets?
I didn't get much sleep. Paula had put towels under the sheet because I had that phenomenon of cold sweat. I was just pacing and I was on the phone quite a lot still. And I was trying to put off leaving. That's the truth. That's right this second what I remember. Just suddenly a blast of that.
I remember opening the curtains and seeing a sunny day. And I think it was one of the few, or maybe the only, sunny day that summer. And I thought, wow, something's happening.
The magnitude of the day ahead was just beginning to dawn on the reluctant BBC boys fronting the show.
I don't really get to sleep, to be honest. I can remember kind of getting up, certainly at about 5 o'clock, and going for a walk by the river. And at 6 o'clock, the phone went. It was Andy Kershaw, my old mate, who lived around the corner. He said, "Hey, Mark, have you got your brown trousers on?" And I remember being absolutely sick with fear, waiting for the BBC car to come and pick me up. And I lived in Chiswick in those days. And the car had already picked up Mark Allen. And even Mark's relentless joshing and wonderful sense of humour in the car up to Wembley couldn't really make me lighten up.
But nobody else wanted to miss out. Even Live Aid's toughest press critic, the NME, sent a solitary hack.
Yeah, I remember getting the tube train up to North London, and of course all the carriages were packed with people going to Live Aid, and it struck me this wasn't a typical concert-going audience of the kind that I was used to from the 70s and the 80s. This wasn't a rock audience as such. This really was Middle England.
Shorts and T-shirts, big bags full of drinks and two sandwiches, liters. Just in case we died of starvation in London.
Yeah, definitely 2 litres of weak orange squash. I vividly remember that, with a handball.
Everybody was nice. Nobody was going to be horrible to each other. You could just feel that. Everybody was smiling. Hiya, hiya. You know, everybody was just terribly excited.
At 10 o'clock, the dam burst.
And Ali just went, "Run!" We all ran across Wembley Stadium.
It was awesome. It was absolutely awesome just to get in there and see all the stage set up, and just a fantastic feeling.
While the fans staked out their turf, just across the river, a massive airlift was getting underway.
JCB, 300 persons on board, and you're fine.
The stars were in the air, and their pilot was TV presenter Noel Edmonds.
There was no space to land helicopters at Wembley, and the nearest spot that we could find was the other side of the tube line, where there is a cricket pitch. The first point of contact pointed out to us there was a very important cricket match on that day. And we said, well, it's Live Aid. The world is watching. This is the only place that we can land. But it's a very important cricket match we've got. This could only happen in this country.
So all these guys in their whites, you know, sort of ready at the bat. Next thing you know, it was up with the stumps, this, in they ran, blah, 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 out came Bono, in a car, Range Rover off, back in the stumps, where were we? You know, back on.
I got there in a helicopter, yes, from my house in Windsor.
because of, not being grand or anything like that, because I just thought the fucking traffic would be a nightmare.
Elton was going through a particularly interesting period in the follicle department, and it was pointed out that when he arrived at Wembley, the rotors of the helicopter had to be stationary for fear that the draft could cause the Elton rug to become detached.
He was very worried about his wig. However, on the day, what he should have been concerned about was his garden.
I wasn't too happy because we just planted some things at the garden and the helicopter took off and more or less destroyed everything that we'd done in that summer trying to plant the things that we did.
And the words that came out of Elton's mouth were just, "My fucking begonias, I've just had them done."
Others were enjoying a different kind of trip.
I remember circling over the place in a helicopter. At least I think I was in a helicopter.
That's true.
Before we went on, and obviously before we went on. And it was just such an amazing sight. I shall never forget that, over the stadium. It just looked so fantastic.
It was like looking down into a sea of mullets. I think I even had one myself back then. They were very popular. And that just... that crackle of anticipation.
At 10:50, and the time is now 12:13, on the two big screens to the side of the stage, the world.
72,000 people sweltered in the baking heat.
I find it incredible that the sort of the mass of people probably feel that something should be done, yet their own governments just don't do anything. They do very little. You know, the very fact that it has to be done by people giving their own money is ridiculous. I mean, we've given enough money into government, why can't they spend some of our money giving it back?
Perfectly honest, we were into the music scene. And, okay, it was a good cause, but I don't think at that age we maybe should have been, but our first priority was having a good time in the music.
Backstage, nobody seemed to know what was going on.
There were a lot of people walking about in clipboards and headphones and looking as though they knew what they were doing. Which, of course, in hindsight, realised that nobody knew what was going on at all. And it was full of pop stars sort of looking quite vacant.
It's the words of wisdom, let it be. Ooh, yeah.
No problem. What time is it?
It's Christmas time, there's no need to be afraid. At Christmas time.
While the stars tuned up, Geldof was his usual manic self.
When we got there, I saw him. He was on a phone next to one of those huge trailers, and he was saying, "Fuck off! No! Stick it up your ass!" And I thought, oh, God, I wonder if it's the right time to say hello. So I wandered up and I said, "Hi, Bobby." He went, "Oh, good, you're here. Hello, Pam, how you doing?" "Oh, good, I'm glad you're here, blah, 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 and it's going great, and tra-la-la." And I said, "Somebody on your back there." He said, "Ah!" He says, "Somebody wanted to put Santana on next." He said, "They're fucking crap." This guy from the Boomtown Rats is telling me that Santana are crap. I think not.
Wrap your arms around the world, yeah, at Christmas
time. With all the chaos backstage, the production crew forgot all about the imminent arrival of the royal couple.
It was a mad rush to hit the phones. "You got to come early." "Why do I come early? I'm on at 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock at night."
Amazingly, everyone came. Rock stars don't get up, do they? But no, if you see the footage, everyone's there. With my heart, yeah.
And everyone was there to meet Britain's most glamorous royal.
And she got to me, and my managers said, this is Nick Kershaw. And she said, I know who he is, which I was very pleased about. Princess Di said to Bob, didn't realise he was so short. I said, sure, he's a fucking midget.
She was completely flirtatious, actually. She was a real sort of, you know, honey. And I'm sure she said something of sort of slightly naughty extract. I seem to remember it was something to do with underwear or suspenders or something a little fruity. All these grown pop stars being completely jelly at Princess Diana, telling, or going, you know, like schoolboys.
While stars were being smitten, television producers were racing against time to write the biggest introduction in television history.
With seconds to go, I got a little voice in my earpiece saying, the royal party are not going on stage, they're going straight to the royal box, so you will have to do the opening. Oh, will we?
He dictated to me with my hands, you know, and I wrote out these words, it's 12 noon in London, 7 a.m. in Philadelphia, read it to myself a couple of times quietly, gave a bit of voice lever on the microphone, and before you knew it, it was 30 seconds, good luck.
And he started to read it. And he'd read the first two or three words when suddenly they switched the PA on in the stadium.
It's 12 noon, and then it goes, it's 12 noon!
It's 12 noon in London, 7 a.m. in Philadelphia. And around the world, it's time for Live Aid.
And then there was this extraordinary moment where Richard and I just embraced each other and cried. We were both quite overcome. It was just kind of... It started, we're all right.
Geldof had chosen the opening act weeks earlier, but they weren't everyone's favourite vintage.
Some chap says, who's opening the show? And Bob went, well, it's obvious who's going to open the show. It's status quo. Rocking all over the world. And I went, oh, no. I'm not sure about that.
Even in 1985, it seemed as if status quo had been around forever, doing exactly the same riff over and over, wearing the same clothes.
Andy was behind me when the announcement was made that status quo were coming on first. And he just turned around and said, oh, fucking stand status quo.
In all the years that we'd been together, even by then, by 85, you know, we weren't necessarily nervous before a gig, bit of nervous energy, but I was really cacking myself before we went out there, you know.
Would you welcome Status Quo?
Looking at the crowds just before they started the opening bars, you know, the hairs on the back of the neck were standing up.
And I was standing there with Tony Hadley, who's about 7'3", isn't he? And you could hear in your headphones, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Down, 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 down.
Arms went up, everyone's clapping, arms above the head. I look behind me, and there's Andy. You fucking hypocrite.
No one will admit it except me, but we thought Status Quo were quite cool when they played. Secretly, you wanted to hate yourself for thinking that, but they were great when they came on.
And Tony Hadley. I just looked up at him, he looked down at me, and we both burst into tears.
The ex-punk Bob Geldof, who'd once written a song knocking the British Empire, was now hobnobbing with his new best friend, the Prince.
And he said, who are these chips over there? And I said, that's Status Quo, sir. And he said, who exactly are they? And I said, I asked them particularly because they're almost a cartoon of rock and roll. It's a band, and he was sort of clapping arrhythmically and stuff like that.
He would have enjoyed a sort of chamber orchestra type of setup, more than a sort of, the cream of the world's glitterati, fritterati, and whatever. And she loved it. She just loved it. I'm sure she would have married Phil Collins if he'd asked her.
To open it, that doesn't bother us at all. Fantastic. Best spot. Sod closing it. Can you imagine?
Across the Atlantic, America was getting ready to join the fray. But one loose cannon threatened disaster. American concert promoter Bill Graham was an angry, difficult control freak. He'd been heading for a showdown with the TV producers. Now, with minutes to go, he tried to restrict their access.
About a half hour prior to the show starting, Bill had our TV badges pulled. Couldn't go to the stage. So all I had was distant cameras. So I got my attorneys and said, I want him either removed off the premises or taken out of our operational issues, or we're yanking it.
The police came in with Mike Mitchell. They were going to arrest Bill Graham for trespass. Because they wanted to get rid of him. And I called Bob right away, and I said, Bob, it's not going to happen. We'll handle the situation. We'll deal with Bill. And we finally got everybody to leave. Everybody calmed down.
A deal was struck. The promoter was banished to the stage area, but he was still looking for trouble.
We've not only been asked to build not only a small reproduction, but a 500-seat Hard Rock Cafe backstage next to the artist area. And Mr. Graham came rolling in there a couple of hours before the whole concert. He had not been over there. Who in the fuck authorized this? That's what he said. and actually, it was him.
As the Wembley concert continued, behind the scenes, the money started to trickle in. £23,000 in the first few minutes. Volunteers manned 300 BBC phone lines to take donations, but Geldof was still anxious.
I thought that people wouldn't watch. I thought that people wouldn't give money. I thought that the political lobby, which so interested me that I could raise this day, would just be wasted. So all that wasted.
And here now is the band that's led by the man who was the spark, Bob Geldof and the Boomtown Rat.
Geldof's own band hadn't had a hit in years. Would they get the money rolling in?
I tried to talk Bob out of performing. I felt it was a bit strange. I don't actually know what he felt about it. I felt uncomfortable. But he wanted to do it.
And indeed, you could argue that had anybody else organised this, the Boomtown Rats would not have got a 15-minute slot at Live Aid.
Thanks for coming.
They were very nervous and very self-conscious and probably felt a little bit rusty and out of their depth.
But the fact was, everyone did want to see Bob Geldof. In fact, I would say on the day, he was as big as anyone else. People really wanted to see the man who'd made it all happen.
Nobody's gonna go to school today. She's gonna make them stay at home. And Daddy doesn't understand it. He always said she was good as gold.
His mind wasn't on it that much, but once he went on stage, he was back in the band. And so for 10 or 15 minutes, he was back in the Boomtown Rats and he was playing the gig. And that was great.
Another playing stopped in the playground now.
He stopped two-thirds of the way through the song. The lesson today is how to die.
We've been learning that the lesson today is how to die.
Because it's not normally a break in the song, but the crowd have gone mental. Bob keeps his hand up for what seemed forever.
Suddenly that line took a completely different meaning.
Minutes later, it was the turn of Geldof's Band Aid partner Midge to face the crowds. His chart-topping band Ultravox had been billed as one of the show's highlights.
It was petrifying walking out there, but the roar, the crowd was just fantastic. It must be how a gladiator felt or how a football hero feels walking onto that thing, you know, to walk onto this massive roar of recognition. The rest of it just disappeared. I would argue the toss now that we weren't on stage for 18 minutes. You were no sooner on, you'd maybe started to break sweat if you were lucky, and then you were off. You were gone again.
Ultravox should have played earlier, at 12:47, but after a last-minute change to the running order, they were swapped with the Boomtown Rats. This meant that by the time Midge and his boys came on, the royal party had left.
As I walked backstage, all the paparazzi were there. And they said, well, how do you feel being shafted by Bob? And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you were swapped round with the Boomtown Rats so that he could perform for the Royals. I said, nah. Yeah.
The Prince and Princess of Wales had agreed to stay for a couple of hours, and so there was a bit of jockeying for position. And it was felt that it was right for Bob to, if he was going to perform within that period in front of them.
Someone who was organising the technical side of things came up to me and said, oh, there's a problem, Adamant's equipment, do you mind if the Rats go on before you? I said, no, don't care, doesn't matter.
It was then quite obvious that, you know, those four bands were playing in front of the royal family. Midge was very keen on the royal family, was keen to play in front of them. But it was decided it wasn't to be, and he was very, very upset about it. But there you go, you know. Yeah, it's just the way it is, isn't it?
It actually wasn't my decision. Probably Bob's decision, really, to decide that he wanted to be on at that point.
Oh, bastard. It probably was Bob, yeah. Well, I thought I've given him the benefit of the doubt and said, well, you know, I'm sure he knows nothing about it, and it was just a swap round.
I didn't even know we'd been swapped, you know, on the day. I certainly wouldn't have requested that. I couldn't give a toss. Just so long as we were on, you know. I insisted upon that. That's for bloody sure, you know.
Whoever gave the go-ahead for the swap, Midgeur felt slighted.
But I think the thing that hurt most was, as a Band-Aid trustee, I was lied to. And it was unnecessary. It didn't have to happen.
But the show had to go on. Some of the outfits were a bit over the top. Spandau Ballet looked like they'd borrowed their mum's blouses to play to 1.5 billion people.
All right, world!
Hey! My nerves started to go. It was knowing that when you walked on stage, you were walking out in front of millions of people worldwide who would be watching and would always say, I remember your show, it was awful, and you couldn't get it wrong.
That we'd played at Wembley Stadium, and for me it was like being in the FA Cup final. It was a dream come true, to be honest.
And I remember going around in his big leather coat on, sweats coming down, you know, and the swung round. And the mics just come flying out of my hand. And I was like, oh no. I tried to be cool and, ha-ha, hey. If I'd had a gun, I would have shot myself at that moment.
Thank you! Thank you!
But there was no respite for the BBC team, marooned in the Wembley commentary box. Their lack of rehearsal was beginning to show.
Andy, we're going to go straight down there, I think, because I think they've already started.
I don't know what's going on.
I'm to clue. I think...
There was mad panic throughout the whole day. What do we do now? Oh, I've no idea.
All right. Oh! Sorry, I didn't realise I was on. I'm now joined by TV's...
The heat was on, and it was getting hotter by the minute.
Because it was so hot in the box, we had these portable air conditioning machines, which were worse than useless, because they were so noisy. Of course, you had to turn them off as soon as the lights were on, which meant that just when you needed them, you couldn't use them. And some guy came up at one stage to fix the air conditioning machines, and we thought he was famous, so we sat him down. And we were within a hair's breadth of interviewing, you know, the man from the AC company. Probably think he was from AC/DC, I don't know.
While mayhem ruled in the BBC box, the unstoppable global jukebox played on, with contributions now coming in from all over Europe.
It's not that you can sing with Camperson.
Hello, this is Vienna, Austria, a small country, but we are very happy.
Hello, hello world.
Hello, this is Hilversum in Holland.
Hello from the JRT studio in Belgrade, Yugoslavia. We are happy and proud to be with you this morning. All you need is love. And to deliver your message from Europe. All you need is love.
One after the other, the cream of British music talent took to the revolving stage, which mercifully worked to plan. People all over the country were celebrating the day. In a farmer's field in Cheshire, 5,000 locals gathered to watch on a giant screen.
We hope to raise a fair bit of money, and we hope to achieve a feeling of actually being able to do something.
We had two mini coaches full of pensioners, all the pensioners in the village, and my Uncle Jim. And they all rolled up, they all came, you know.
So do you like the music?
Some of it, not all of it.
I think the whole movement's inspired everybody, just everywhere. You know, the whole world, isn't it? I mean, I've given more to charity with this one than I've ever given any time.
This is called Against All Odds.
How can I just let you walk away? Just let you leave without a trace?
Phil Collins was to perform live in London and Philadelphia, where rock and roll giants Led Zeppelin invited him to join their set. There was just time for a quick chat with that friend of the stars, Andy Kershaw.
I did feel some unease about having to rub shoulders with and, in some cases, interview a lot of pop stars who I didn't actually detest personally, but whose music I was well known for not liking.
Andy's style was to say, "Oi, you, speaking as a wanker, what do you think?" And if you said to him, "I think you've got to introduce Howard Jones now," he'd go, "Oh, fucking hell." And, "Oh, come on, Andy, come along. It's all for the starving kids. It'll be all right."
So at one point, I found myself sitting around with the holy trinity of Sting, Phil Collins, and the ubiquitous Howard Jones.
Well, this is a BBC economy measure. We've only got one microphone among us all. Crowd in a bit.
Hello, mate.
How do you two lads come to get together to collaborate on this one?
Performers whose music, for me, epitomised everything that was bland, mainstream, insipid, tragic, gave rock and roll a bad name.
I was a bit nervous about that, actually, because I thought, well, he's not going to like me. I just wondered that he might, like, have a go or something.
We'll just have a quick word with Howard. It's been an expensive trip for you, I understand. Was it worth it for just the 5 minutes on stage?
It would have been worth it just to do one note, I think.
I think that's the moment where I told Phil Collins to shove off.
What are you doing here anyway? Because I thought you ought to be on Concord and heading for America. Will you shove off? Go on.
Which is just like, I don't know if you can be much ruder, really. I don't think so.
The race was on to get Collins to Heathrow in time for his transatlantic flight, courtesy of Concorde.
Listen, whose idea was this whole trip, this Philadelphia idea?
No idea. No, it was, we thought if it could be done, wouldn't it be good to do it? And then we went into the logistics.
And I said, I'm not going to be the only one doing it, am I? Because it's a bit show-offy. And they said, no, there's going to be a few other people who are going to be doing it.
But everyone blamed poor old Phil.
Although I thought Phil was being a complete prick when he first asked that, I thought, you know, come on, man, what are we doing this for? It actually was one of our highlights.
As we know, nobody else did it. I was the only stupid one doing it.
Now, you may have heard that earlier Phil Collins performed here with Sting and that he was helicoptered out of here to Heathrow.
Mid-flight, the supersonic pop star was due to be brought back down to Earth for a studio chat.
When I got taken into the cockpit, the captain said, you're going to have a word with London now. Now, I'm not supposed to let you do this, so please don't tell anybody. And then he gave me the mic, you know, this sort of... to beam to 2 million people.
Somewhere way up in the sky over the Atlantic in Concorde.
I couldn't hear anything. There's here now. There's magic of electronics and engineering. We're going to talk to Phil Collins.
I'm here on Concorde. Who is that over? This is the director in London. Over.
I was dying to talk to him. And I wish I could have spoken to him because I would have told him not to sing the same song when he got there. But I just go...
A minute. I'm just Phil. It feels very nice to be here. I'm in the cockpit here with these wonderful chaps. Why are you doing this, Phil? How much good is yours, really? What do you do?
It goes on and it goes on, and we're all looking at each other on the ground going, they've got to pull this in a minute. But it kept going.
I'm stunned. I'm absolutely flabbergasted. Apart from the fact that I didn't hear a word, I have to believe you. It came in your ear. But I don't know how those things work. I don't know how regular telephones work, far less phone in an aeroplane.
You've got two cocoa tins and a bit of string, have you?
Yes, I'm still there.
Back on Earth. Philadelphia was standing by to go live at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, 12 noon East Coast time. For one performer at Wembley, it was a particularly nail-biting experience.
Just coming to terms with the fact that 100,000 people were going to see us. Then Bob made it even worse because he said, America's going to go live halfway through your act. So I'm going to be on the side. When you see me appear at the side of the stage, when you're in that number, I'm going to come on. So I thought, great. So now I'm panicking because I've never played a stadium. I'm panicking because somewhere during the show, I'm going to be worldwide live. And I've got to keep one eye over this way for Bob.
Wembley, will you please welcome America to Live Aid Day? Hello, America. Welcome to the world. Have a great day. Have as good a day.
Over in Philadelphia, their first act, an equally nervous Bryan Adams, was waiting to play to the world.
Have a good day.
We were sort of standing on the side of the stage. Your guy says, all right, Brian, that gentleman over there is going to be introducing you. Just so you know, you're the first person that's going live to the UK. And so make sure you say hello to London. I said, okay. And wait for that gentleman's cue, and then you can start. I said, okay. So looked over, and it was Jack Nicholson introducing me.
Bryan Adams. Middle of a tour, he's come here to entertain you.
Hey, Philadelphia! Hello, London! Hello, world! This is the summer of 69. Got my first with a six string. Body at the 5 and 10. Played it till my fingers bled. Was the summer of 69. Me and some guys from school. I went and tried real hard. Jimmy quit, Jody got married. Should've known we'd never get far. When I look back now,
from now on, viewers across the globe could follow the action as it switched between Wembley and Philadelphia. In Britain, millions tuned in to watch the first national live TV event since the wedding of Prince Charles and Lady Di.
Later in the afternoon, about tea time, I was sent back to TV Centre to do some video editing. And I was sitting in a car with all the windows open. It was such a hot day. And at no point from Wembley Stadium to Television Centre in Shepherd's Bush did we need to put a radio on. from the houses we drove past, you could just hear Live Aid. It was everywhere. And that was the moment, I think, that it's really struck me that culturally this was going to have a massive impact.
And as I drove up, seeing all the windows open, it was one of those, it was like a Jubilee Day. It was like a sort of big British celebration. You could hear it coming out of every window, every street you went down.
So I ended up kind of staking out the television and saying, well, no one's coming near it because I'm just going to watch it right the way through. And I did. I just sat there and watched it right the way through on a brilliantly beautiful summer's day in South Wales.
Around the world, 1.5 billion people, 165 countries were tuning in to see, share, and participate in the same event.
I had to be there, I had to see it, I had to know what was going on, and I did. It was my education. It was my school of rock.
Today is something unique. We've never seen westernized country before. We always heard by the radio, and is a chance to see on the television. They are involving the people. Hi, America! And they are in UK. And the American people say, hi, India! And people like me, oh, my God, they are looking to me. You know, oh, yeah, they talk about India, you know.
Live Aid was the first major demonstration of the potential for global satellite communications.
Here the world was participating in an event. The Germans were participating, the Japanese were participating, we had the Russians, the Australians.
We were bringing people together throughout the world. We were showing we were a global village. We are one humanity.
Further groundbreaking moves were afoot. In 1985, the West and Russia were at the height of the Cold War. The threat of nuclear attack was never far away.
To ignore the facts of history and the aggressive impulses of an evil empire, to simply call the arms race a giant misunderstanding, and thereby remove yourself from the struggle between right and wrong and good and evil.
But for the first time, a TV concert was about to bring the Russians in from the chill.
Once again, to prove that this is a totally international show today, we're moving abroad for the first time ever seen in the West, one of the most popular Soviet groups. Live from Moscow, here's Autograph.
I had been told that Russia was standing by, and music was ready, and the band was ready. And as soon as we cut to Russia, up came a scene of cherry pickers.
And we thought, that's very strange. Maybe this is how the Russians interpret Western videos.
You start off thinking, I expect they know what they're doing, and, you know, in a minute, somebody will come on and say, well, those very cherries that are being picked now are being bundled up and sent to Ethiopia.
The cherry pickers continued to gather their harvest for two more baffling minutes until a technician, deep in the bowels of Russian television, finally switched the feed.
We were watching pictures from Bulgaria, a documentary about fruit picking, and getting the sound out of Russia with the band playing. So we had this weird period of time when nobody really knew what the hell was going on.
Not for the first or the last time.
In 1985, U2 were rising stars. They hadn't yet cracked the international stage, but that didn't stop them from being difficult. Only the night before, they threatened to pull out. Would they come good on the day?
Fade away. No.
like the distance between stage and crowd. I don't like the distance between performer and audience. So I'm looking for a symbol of the day, something that, yeah, that I can hold on to. And I saw her down there getting crushed. I said, that's it.
I've been good at distances. I don't think he realised that when she climbed down that there was like a 2-mile walk to get to the punters.
And I didn't know when I was holding on to her I would be holding on to the rest of the world, really. Because everyone wanted to be... Everyone was shaken, is the truth. People were disturbed. They knew that this kind of wall that they had built up, that we had built up, between the us and them, was coming down.
Bonner was lost in his own world, but the rest of the band couldn't see where he'd got to and were beginning to panic.
How long can we do this for? It was like, this is on and on. It was kind of excruciating. And we didn't know whether we should stop, we didn't know where he was, we didn't know if he'd fallen. And we sort of, just as we were about to like stop, and just climbs back up onto the stage. We were kind of annoyed afterwards because we felt like, you know, we'd blown an opportunity to, you know, to be great. It was our stage, and so we felt a little angry about that. I always felt, oh shit, it's all going wrong, when in actual fact it wasn't, it was actually all going right. Goodbye, Ruby Tuesday,
who's gonna hang your name on you? They seem to have a grandeur about them. Goodbye. I think Live Aid was the point at which U2 became a big stadium band. It really was the making of U2 as an international act. Holly came from Miami, FLA, hitchhiked all the way. She could feel the satellite coming down. Pretty soon she was in London town. Wembley Stadium and all the people.
Crap sound, crap haircuts, and didn't end up playing the hit, Pride in the Name of Love, because the singer fucked off into the crowd. Band wanted to fire me as a result. And it turned out to be one of the best days of our life. Explain that. Ask God. He probably knows.
Thank you. God bless you.
Bono wowed the crowd. But he didn't have quite the same effect on two female coppers working backstage.
A photographer came up and... he asked us, would we mind having our photo taken with this chap? And we entered into the spirit of the thing, didn't we, Iris?
We did.
And said, yes, we don't mind. And so he stood in between Iris and I, and he had a can of beer in his hand, and he gave us a kiss, and the photo was taken. And when I came around, I said, well, who was that? And he said, that's Bono. And I said, Bono who? And he said, you too. And I said, you too what? We hadn't got a clue who he was.
More than anyone else, stadium supergroup Dire Straits kept their eye anxiously on the clock throughout their set. The megastars were in the middle of their sellout tour at Wembley Arena, down the road, and they had to get back there for their own gig an hour later.
Now, of course, we had to go back almost immediately to do our regular performance to the 12,000 Dire Straits fans who would much rather have actually been at the Live Aid gig, but they'd already bought their tickets, so they were stuck.
getting away from the Wembley crowds wasn't as easy as getting in. But once again, two ladies in blue came to the rescue.
When a chap came up, we were backstage, and he said to me, "We're in dire straits. We need to get our stuff out quick." And I said, "No problem." And we found the Wembley security. And I said, "These blokes are in dire straits and they need to get out quick. They've got to be down at a venue." And he couldn't stop laughing. And he said, "But they are dire straits. That's their name."
The world was watching, but the money wasn't flooding in, and Geldof was beginning to panic.
I didn't dare ask, were we making any money? That's the truth, I was afraid to ask. And eventually I had to. And they said, "Yeah, it's going great." And I said, "Jeez, you know, like, how much?" And it was pathetic, I think 1.5 million. And it was truly pathetic, and I freaked out.
Bob was just fed up with the fact that we were not putting enough appeals into the programme and didn't appear to be remembering the purpose of the programme.
Geldof headed for the BBC box up in the gantries, just as Queen were getting ready to go on stage.
I see a little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo,
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 Galileo
Figaro.
Magnifico!
The flamboyant rockers had been massive in the 70s, but many now thought they were past it.
Sparing his life from this monstrosity.
For Live Aid, we were bored, I think. We were quite... We'd had a long, fairly long career by then. And I think we were in a bit of a trough.
Queen had played at Sun City in South Africa during the apartheid era.
I think that anybody that has played there, I don't want to... Actually, I won't mention names. Rod Stewart and Queen and people like that have played there. They're jerks for doing it, and they were more than aware of what they were doing, and I think that they should be called out for it.
And for them, subsequently to appear at Live Aid as the benefactors of Africa struck some people as being hypocritical.
It's interesting that they were the most nervous backstage. They were the most... They'd been arguing, they'd fallen out. They thought Queen didn't matter anymore.
Anyway, it gives us enormous pleasure to introduce the next combo, who are... Her Majesty! Queen!
I do remember, I think we were quite tense. Quite tense. Before we went on, just hoping it was all going to work, you know, that the equipment wouldn't break down.
So would Freddie and the boys pull it off?
Stole the show. Queen were Live Aid.
Queen was one of the seminal moments in the history of the 20th century. Forget Hitler, forget the invention of the internet or whatever. Queen's performance was absolutely A1.
It's Queen's Day, I think.
Yeah.
They just stole the show.
Best thing there. Fantastic. Gob shines.
On his way to berate the BBC, Geldof stopped in his tracks.
When I was walking along the top, and I looked out, and they started, and I saw the Radio Gaga. Just thought, this is extraordinary.
Radio Goo-Goo, Radio Gaga, all we hear is Radio Gaga.
This was pop history in the making.
Radio Gaga.
Every single person
and that whole place was clapping along to Radio Gaga and singing along. I thought, fantastic, I wish we had a song like that.
Freddie's command of the crowd even stretched across the Atlantic.
But looking out onto the audience, 90,000 Philadelphians, you know, on cue with a television screen, I just thought that was powerful, really powerful. And yeah, that brought us together. That was the one moment I thought, we don't have to be in London, we're here and we're part of it.
Freddie Mercury was only just getting started.
I can't tell you what it feels like to be on a stage like that, in that situation where you have no control. And, you know, there is an infinite space underneath your feet if you fall, you know. It would be appalling if you really screw up, you know. And Freddie just thinks, oh, what the hell, you know, hey-o.
Call and response. Freddie would call, they would respond. And they loved it. They wanted to do it. A fascinating kind of power.
I do remember coming away from that concert thinking, I must go and buy a Queen album immediately. Like the rest of the world, and I think Queen got a huge resurgence of interest.
Just as Queen were finishing their set, Geldof stormed into the BBC box, still fuming about the failure to raise enough money.
So I was wound up by how great this was, having seen these guys, been magnificent, and suddenly I'm there and it's cosy, you know, celeb, DJ pop-tastic stuff.
I've been joined, as you can see, by Pamela Stevenson, Billy Connolly, Ian Astbury from The Cult, and once again, Bob Geldof.
It's all
Bob,
a bit telethon-ish. And that wasn't what this is, you know. I mean, the thing calling a charity did and drove me nuts. For me, this was finely tuned politics.
You know, you've got to get on the phone and take the money out of your pocket. Don't go to the pub tonight. Please stay in and give us the money. There are people dying now, so give me the money. And here's the numbers.
Let's read go them through out. The way. I think we're probably going to get the address first, aren't we?
What the fuck? We've got satellites. We've got space shuttles or not. We've got Concorde. We've got, you know, what's it? Right. You know, it seemed to me of another time. This notion that you do telethons, you charity concerts, you do smashy and nice, you do, you know, shut up.
No, let's fuck the address, let's get the numbers, because that's how we're going to get it.
And I'm thinking, actually, what everybody, every embarrassed TV presenter is thinking in those circumstances, I do hope my mother's not watching this. I think we're going to have the address first, and the address which you can...
He's
you
in
can
like a burning elephant, you know. Give me your fucking money and I'll come and get you. I'll kill your family.
It's a sort of regular feature, though, of life with Bob after a time.
And so it came to pass. Geldof became famous for something he didn't actually say.
Give us your fucking money.
Give us your fucking money.
Give us your money. Give us your fucking money now.
Give us your fucking money. And it was brilliant. And everyone went, yes, yes. So it forever will be, give me the fucking money. Like, and I get it all the time going down the street. Unfortunately, it's my one gift to the nation, give me the fucking money, you know? So, but I didn't say it.
Stay in and give us the money. There are people dying now, so give me the money.
And from that moment onwards, the lines just went mad. So Bob's deliberate use of the swear word triggered this fantastic, an immediate reaction.
Tonight, a tense Geldof was summoned to the phone.
and the appeal claimed its biggest individual donation from the ruling family of Dubai.
£1 million.
£1 million. Well done. Fantastic.
Great.
While Geldof's language shocked punters into parting with their cash, in Philadelphia, promoter Bill Graham was still on the prowl.
Won't you come see about me? I'll be alone.
Simple minds were overrunning, and Graham resorted to his usual star-handling tactics.
Bill at that point has got me almost in a headlock. You told me these guys have this song the last 4 minutes or 3 minutes or whatever. I said, well, Bill, what do you want to do? Go and stop them. There's a billion people watching the telly. I mean, look, I'll tell them to cut the set to 2 songs.
Right. La 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 la.
I get up behind Mel Gaynor on drums and say, we'll need to cut it after this song. And so the word somehow or other gets to Jim as he's finishing the second song. Tumultuous applause, great reception. And of course, somehow or other, they've caught up on time.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
The band go to walk off, and Bill goes, what are they doing to me? And I said, well, you just told us. Don't be stupid, get them on again, you know. And something goes, okay, get on, go on, go on, go on.
Some old pros got temperatures soaring. But other young Turks didn't quite hit the right note.
It would be very cruel of me to actually pick on anybody and say, yeah, they weren't great because this happened or whatever. But there is the famous Simon Le Bon yodel.
All the times to go and do that.
At the time, I was mortified. Absolutely mortified. We'd been rehearsing for 2 days, and I'd given myself a bit of a sore throat doing that because we'd just hammered it and hammered it and hammered it.
We've all done it, but, you know, don't do it in front of all those people, Simon. Please.
And no one who was present would ever be able to forget a certain pop diva's behaviour backstage.
Suddenly these minders came in and said, OK, everyone clear the area. And I was sitting with Jim Kerr chatting to him, and, you know, we're from Glasgow. We went, no, why? And they went, just clear the area. I went, no, we're just not clearing the area. And in came Madonna, and Madonna wanted to use the toilet. So she didn't want anywhere near her. So of course we just sat outside the portal going. And then as soon as she came out again, the student went, I'd give it a few minutes before he used that one.
In London, another diva, emboldened by his stage performance, was honing his seduction skills.
I want to break free.
So when Freddie Mercury comes up to me and goes, hello, we've all agreed, it'll be like you. I went, oh. And he had me up against a wall, and Freddie was being really playful with me. And I walked off and I went, He's really very camp, isn't he? Somebody said, Queen.
God knows I want to break free.
He got me in an arm lock, you see. He said, it's all right, darling, I'm not going to hook you. And so I thought, wow.
Is he Welsh then?
He was Welsh when I was with him. And I thought, well, if he wanted to, he could have done. And it was a little learning curve there, because I thought, up until now, I thought that gay men were kind of feeble, Freddie wasn't. If Freddie wanted you, he was going to have you.
So Freddie's got my hand still after talking for 2 minutes and he's not letting go, which the cool guys thought was just hysterical. They're snorting away in the corner. And then he completely blew it for me by saying, but you're that lovely boy in the Boomtown Rats, aren't you? I said, no, I'm the lovely boy from Ultravox.
Back on stage, David Bowie had the crowd eating out of his hand. Bowie finished his set early, and the mood was about to change.
Bob asked me if there's any way that I could find a place to show this wonderful video that the cast had put their song to. And I think I cut my set short a bit so that they could use the video.
God bless you, you're the heroes of this concert. Lest we forget why we're here, I'd like to introduce a video made by CBC Television. The subject speaks for itself. Thank you. Good night. Please send your money in.
It was a moment the audience in the stadium and at home
atmosphere completely changed. I mean, completely changed. It went icy cold. It was the most extreme set of emotions I've ever experienced. And I'll never have that again. I know that. Who's gonna hang it up?
I remember looking that way, I remember the screen being to the right and everyone looking at it and just crying, and it was,
I remember the woman next to me hugging me.
Yeah.
Everybody was very emotional, I think.
You can't go on.
The Drive film was a bludgeon. If fuck was a slap, this was a club across the head. Who's gonna
drive you home? And I'm watching this thing, and this wee boy, he's I'm getting very moved even as I speak about it. He was like this, all of a sudden. Now, a child it's a position a child should never be in. It's like an old guy in a Domino's hut in the public park. And as the music was so beautiful, and then he went like that, you know, he put his head in his hands, this wee guy. He's only a baby. He's only starting. He doesn't know what's going on. He did that, and I just couldn't. I wasn't in control of it. It just went.
Sitting there, and I'm just aware that you know I'm filling up a little bit, but you know Billy and Pamela, it's tears rolling now, and clearly that experience was being replicated in living rooms all across the UK and probably beyond.
Well, it's pictures like that that started this whole thing off, and there's not really much you can say after seeing those. Makes music.
The video was a revelation for one skeptic watching the concert at home in Hertfordshire. She was the Red Cross nurse in Ethiopia who had originally sparked Geldof's compassion.
It suddenly dawned on me that actually they were fighting as hard as I was for Ethiopia. And I wanted to talk to them and apologise for my feelings back in December when I first heard Band-Aid singing Do They Know It's Christmas, and I wanted to apologise to them and say, this is fantastic, you're marvellous, I'm sorry I had these bad thoughts.
The phone lines lit up again. The money was now rolling in at £20,000 a minute. Live Aid was galvanising the nation as never before.
I would have been one of millions of people who have been slightly floundering with this. What can you do? And where do you give money to? And, of course, they made it very easy for you.
I remember before Live Aid, when you thought about giving to Africa, it was that rather dreary envelope from Christian Aid that used to land on the doorstep, you know, with an oxen ploughing a furrow. And you maybe sort of put a pound in it and send it off. But this was suddenly trendy. You know, it was pop stars and it was popular culture. And giving was hip.
Collins made it onto the stage at Philadelphia with seconds to spare.
It was a bridge to tie the two concerts together.
He was about to realize his dream, playing live with Led Zeppelin, who reformed especially for Live Aid.
Thank you very much. I'd like to introduce some friends of mine to you. Would you welcome Mr. Robert Plant?
America, boy, they were huge. And this was like, Zeppelin, man! Shit! You know, this was the second coming.
Before the set, he went backstage to meet the band.
But there's a strange thing that when the Zeppelin guys get together, there was this black cloud, you know. The whole atmosphere changed. Darkness. And I remember arriving and going into their trailer and saying, hi guys, okay. So, and Jimmy Page said, so how does it go, Stairway to Heaven, huh? How does it go? So I said, well, you know, I know where, this is where I come in, and I go, da-da-da-dum, da-da-da-dum. He said, no, no. And I thought, okay. It was like I was being torn up, taken apart, in a very weird way.
Led Zeppelin said their own performance was substandard. And since then, they've blocked all attempts to broadcast it.
They were in a funny mood during it. And Jimmy was dribbling everywhere, and Robert's voice wasn't sung in. I actually, there's quite a lot of me when I kind of, my hands go up in the air not playing. You know, I'm playing and then there's a fill coming and I sort of just play the air for a bit and then come back in. I did toy with the idea momentarily at that point of walking off. But I couldn't walk off, because we'd all be sitting here talking about that now.
Led Zeppelin later blamed Phil Collins for their disappointing performance.
Your
I said, well, you know, what can you expect? We had one drummer that was halfway across the Atlantic. And I said, well, don't fucking have a go at me. You guys were off, man. I was together. I knew my stuff. We won't try to put us down. They do look awful.
Back at Wembley, another rock and roll giant was about to fall victim, this time to the BBC's technical gremlins. Why don't you all... Worse was to come. After weeks of schmoozing and ego massaging, pop legend Paul McCartney had finally agreed to take part. He hadn't performed live for 6 years.
I was so unrehearsed. Bob just sort of said, oh, the piano's just round that curtain there. It's the white one. Well, I couldn't hear anything. I couldn't hear myself or anything, and the crowd was sort of going wild. I couldn't hear anything. And normally you've got a little bit of a monitor or something, and you can sort of hear ding, ding, ding. OK, that's my piano. You know, when I've heard, that's my voice, here we go. There was nothing.
At home got some sound, but in the stadium, they could hear nothing.
And I'm thinking, oh, I'm the guy that told him, you know, about nuts and bolts and tickety-boo. They can't hear him. I showed him a picture of the sound system and they can't hear him.
I wanted to sink into a hole when it all went wrong. He was probably the most important artist for us on the show to give it credibility. And I've always been a bit sad about that. In fact, never worked for Paul McCartney since.
Paul McCartney was singing to himself for nearly 2 minutes before the sound engineers finally switched on his mic.
The great thing was that audience joined in. God bless the audience. They joined in and saved the day, you know, and I said, it was all like, okay.
Okay, now you. One more time, and when the night is cloudy.
I remember having to share, oh, to my eternal shame, having to share a microphone with David Bowie and then seeing later that I'd hogged it. Oh, my God, the humiliation. I don't believe I've done that. David Bowie. David Bowie, the microphone with me.
The stars trooped on stage for the sing-along that everybody had been waiting for.
think you know the next song. It might be a bit of a cock-up, but if you're going to cock it up, you may as well do it with 2 billion people watching this. So let's cock it up together. Goodbye, Philadelphia. Goodbye, America. We hope you have a good rest of the day. David's going to start this.
No time to be afraid. It must have been so fantastic. I wished I'd been there.
Yeah, me too.
Because I've seen the footage back. I'm swaying away at the back there, lovely. Singing away like a pub singer, pint in one hand, lovely. And I knew.
I was kind of walking backwards into the crowd to sink into the, you know, I wasn't going to get up there start fighting for mics. And Bob grabbed me by the arm and pulled me forward and stuck a mic in my face. So I did it, eventually sing a line on the song.
George Michael grabbed a mic and said, sing.
Thanks.
And if my ego's a bit bruised later, it soon died away. It wasn't a problem, you know, it didn't matter. It wasn't about that at all. It was about pulling it off. And we pulled it off.
We're back to Philadelphia now. Thank you very much for coming. Please leave the stadium slowly and quietly. It's been the most fantastic day. Thank you.
The end was just unbelievable, unbelievable. We're conducting that band. Great. What? Ask me a question.
I'm proud.
Brilliant. Staggering. Ho hum. Let's go home.
Just a perfect day. Drink sangria in the park. And then later, when it gets dark, we go home.
In 12 frenzied weeks, and against all the odds, Bob Geldof had pulled off the impossible.
Donations and tributes to the concert that captured the conscience of the world have gone on pouring in
today. The young people of Britain and America, moved by the plight of thousands of others,
around the world,
thousands of miles.
But they're now talking about an estimated total of £40 million.
Oh, it's such a perfect day. I'm glad I spent it with you. Oh, such a perfect day.
The donations were far bigger than anyone could have hoped. More than £50 million for the starving of Africa. And it was a day that no one who lived through it would ever forget.
It was one of those moments, and there aren't many of those in life, that everyone has got a common experience of it. Everyone remembers where they were. Everyone remembers what they felt about it. It was one of those little pegs you hang all your other memories on.
You're going to reap just what you sow.
Live Aid changed forever the attitude of people who thought nothing could be done about something enormous.
Brave.
Bollocks.
Brash.
Big-headed twat.
And bullying.
Cantankerous.
He's a cunt.
Can't count and count.
Difficult.
A fucking lunatic.
Fucking great.
Gift of gab.
He's a good man.
He's irascible.
Indignant.
Intimidating.
He's outrageous.
Irish scruffy wanker.
Passionate.
Pain in arse.
Superb human being.
Stubborn.
And rude.
The combination of him being a horrible stroppy bastard, being incredibly aggressive and forceful, having an enormous initiative and drive, actually were the things that made this happen. Because if you'd been rather nice and quiet and, you know, self-effacing and self-deprecating, you couldn't possibly have put such an enormous project together. Bob likes his position of power, and he uses it pretty well, but he can bully at the same time. He can be dominant, ignore all the advice around him when he feels like it. But on the other hand, he can be kind and caring, and he'll listen.
What Bob did is he actually went for it, and he did it. And, you know, who can say that? Anyone that can criticize him, or anyone that can say, yes, but, you know, it's like, fuck off, you wanker. Because, you know, he actually went out and did it. And he did something that, frankly, I don't know anyone else that could do it.
He actually proved that rock and roll can make a difference, and musicians can make a difference. And they did and continue to make a difference today. That is democracy. And long live Bob Geldof.
And Radio 2 marks the 20th anniversary of Live Aid with an inspirational look back on the day that rocked the world. That's Tuesday night, 8:30, BBC Radio 2.